Good evening, morning, afternoon, whatever applies to you, and welcome to another World EuroLeague show. I am joined, as always, by Mr. Kira, by Nymera, and by Watashi from the Tatami Galaxy.
Oh, that's Hello. A really weird show. I have actually heard of that one. Yeah. That's like meant to be like one of those really thought-provoking abstracts. Things which does very different things that like visually to make you think about things.
Yeah. Exactly, yeah. It's on brand for Peter, who is, I believe, the protagonist in this show. So you know, and I'll give you a very brief blurb, which I don't believe you know has any spoilers in whatsoever. Which is, after encountering a demigod, a university student relives three years to try and win a girl's heart.
Mm. Oh, really? Kira's assuming the anime position.
Yeah.
No, I seem to remember, I can't remember if I finished that show, but I watched it. It is one of those meant to be like very artistic, thought-provoking kind of shows.
Well, the art style is very, well, stylized. Yeah, it's like it's like almost watercolor kind of, or like crayon-y. Yeah.
Oh, funny enough, there is one anime I know that was watercolor. It's not this one. Grimgar of Fantasy and Ash is kind of like a fantasy show, which is all watercolor. I think it was actually funded by a K-pop star because they really wanted to see that be developed. But that was really cool. Visually, just really, really cool. That's all I can remember in terms of watercolor anime, but yeah.
Sorry, Peter, did you have a thought there that was bursting to get out?
Normally, I'm the anime translator, so Rich will just say, you look like this character. And I'm like, oh, I have either heard, not heard of, or would have this opinion on this show. And then, exactly. Then we move on to better, brighter things.
Yeah.
For anyone in the UK, it's like those Blue Peter bits from the late 90s where it's like, hi, I'm the host and I'm here to learn about fracking. And then it like pans to Nymera, who's like, ah, shit. Got to do my smart notes on fracking.
Yeah.
For anyone else from the UK, that reference is completely lost. So brilliant.
Yeah, I remember doing a bit of that in high school.
Miss the fracking Blue Peter episode? I feel like
I might have been reaching for something a bit extreme there. It's usually
No. I actually did do a bit because I did physics and we did do a little bit of environmental science stuff as part of that in first year. Well, so I could probably dig deep and get some uni notes if you want. But yeah, I wouldn't particularly want to right now, and I don't think the best concept.
How many of the viewers know what Blue Peter is?
Well, exactly.
True.
About
1%.
Oh, wait, I just realized this is a rare, like, quad. We're all British, aren't we?
Yep.
Correct.
And League of Legends, a very rare.
Damn,
like,
where do you feel like colonizing today, folks?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, if this was a league team, we'd be pretty doomed, I'd imagine.
And we're about
all Brits on it, but.
Jeez. Very interesting. I've just really clocked on, you know.
But anyway, so for anyone who doesn't know who Watashi, aka Peter Dunn, is, obviously, you will do, but, you know, he is obviously a minor league enjoyer, which we will be talking about today. He obviously coached INTZ for you old school people out there who don't have the memory of a goldfish. So, he is well placed to talk about what we just saw today, obviously, at the end of play-ins. And also, we will, of course, be discussing some of the Swiss stuff because it just got announced who's playing who. Not all of them because, I mean, the schedule's really weird. It's like 9 best of ones in a row, like all on the same day. Just boom, 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 one after the other. So they better not hope for pauses because, I mean, every time they switch team, there's new peripheral setups and new things that can go wrong with... Riot Games, so yeah, I expect that could go well into the early hours of the morning, potentially, if anything goes wrong, even though it's listed to end at like 9. Spoiler alert, that's not going to happen. It's going to end at like midnight, probably. But anyway,
if there are any... When you have to set up that many best of ones with teams on stage, it's a lot of setup time. I wonder if they'll do pre-recorded drafts, actually, for best of one. I wonder if they'll actually bring that in, I'm not sure.
I would guess not, just because it's...
No, I would hope not, because it's not... And it's also not what people have done in their regional leagues, but it's what they did for LEC to try and keep transition times down. But that's just a thought.
Yeah, I think because other teams or leagues haven't done it, they probably won't spring it on them now. But yeah, who knows? We'll see, but I doubt it. But yeah, you know, anyway, before we talk about all things esports, guys, you're not getting away without answering my would you rather. And this time, it's actually almost a question like previously asked before. I know, I never rehash questions, but two things. One, I thought... There are still many interesting answers to this, which aren't the ones you originally gave. And I'm going to expand the scope just a tiny bit. So the question is quite open-ended, and it goes as follows, which is, Oh, and by the way, you're not allowed to give the same answer again. If you can remember the answer that you gave or remotely similar, you know, that's just simply not allowed, of course. But I want to know from you guys, I'll start with Kira. What unanswered question would you most want the answer to? Now, last time I asked this, it was kind of through the lens of, I don't know, like a conspiracy theory or like, you know, something more of like a public interest matter, I guess. But I mean, it can be anything. It could be like if your ex cheated on you. I don't know. Whatever, you know, whatever the scope is. I'll give you an example first, and to give you some thinking time, I would go. Or last time I went for, you know, who was Jack the Ripper? Because I think that's a very interesting question.
Oh, is this find out one secret? Yes, get to know any one thing.
Exactly, but not like, you know, what is the meaning of life? Something that is possible to know,
right?
Not, you know, so last time I said Jack the Ripper because I thought, you know, canonically it's probably none of the suspects, so I think that'd be really interesting to see who the fuck it was. But maybe it was, who knows? I don't know. I'd say maybe, you know, what is the oldest advanced civilization of all time? Because we kind of think we know, you know, maybe it's Mesopotamia, but we're not actually.
So what's
really
changed
sure
about the question then, in terms of what?
Well,
it's,
I just have expanded the scope. As I said, it could be anything. It could be who stole your sandwich from, you know, the LPL fridge nightmare. It could be. It doesn't have to be a conspiracy theory. It doesn't have to be. It's just, what question do you, right here, right now, nightmare? What do you want to know? Tell me. Tell me now.
How long's it been? It's been about a year. Maybe I can get away with this. So, I would like to know what happened to the Tibbers little plush bear that shut down the English LPL broadcast last year. Many people might know this story. When we were out in Xi'an this time last year, there was basically the LPL English broadcast had zero budget. And I'm just going to hope that a year is long enough for this to be okay to talk about. But effectively, because the LPL English broadcast had no budget, they also had no budget for like set decorations and stuff too. And basically what happened was there was a Tibbers bear that was on the desk and someone asked, hey, I really like that. Can I swap it for another plushie? And someone said, yes. Now that Tibbers plushie obviously got switched out. And then the problem was they needed that exact same bear back. And because they didn't get that exact same bear back because it was switched around, they got in a load of trouble with the higher ups for not bringing back the exact same merch which they were loaned because the English LPL broadcast had no budget for it. And we still have no idea where the hell the Tibbers went. We actually don't know where it went. It wasn't in any random hotel room. It wasn't on set. It just disappeared. So for personal interest, where the hell did that Tibbers go? What ended up with it? Because this exploded so much that I think it was the final straw which like got LPL English shut down from the Chinese
How
side.
Big was this bear? Like,
no,
scale
not big.
Wise.
It was like a 30 quid bear, if anything like that. And it went missing somehow, some way. There are some details which I'm like omitting to like save names and stuff like that. But this is like an open secret within the casting world. A lot of people know what happened to this. This Tibbers bear, like, it went missing. Things exploded as far as I'm aware. And then just a month later, there was just like, yeah, there's no LPL English next year.
So I
want to know where the hell this went, because we are certain that no one of the talent had this bear anywhere randomly weaseled away or anything like that. We didn't see it anywhere on set. And if someone had it, like at that point, it was so, everyone was so tense because it was just like escalating so much, it would have returned at some point. Where the hell did this bear go? I actually have no idea. I know I didn't have it, obviously.
I want to know who escalated it. This is the bigger question to me. Who gives a fuck? Like, why was this a thing?
It's absolutely insane that this escalated to the degree that it did. But effectively, LPL English was running on such a shoestring budget. The fact that they were effectively loaned out some merch and some stuff to put on desk to show on the broadcast, and they didn't get exactly what they wanted back. It ended up going, it was an authority thing, it was a budget thing, so it would have to, if they had to rebuy one, it would have to come out of a budget that wasn't there. And as far as I'm aware, it escalated up in terms of higher ranks, that it exploded out of control. So I want to know where the hell this bear went.
From a Chinese perspective, I kind of get it. Like, I mean, it's like a gift. If you're given the gift, it's like really, really important. Because essentially, it's not a loan anymore. It's now like a gift, so it's disrespecting the gift.
And again, this is like an open secret. A lot of people kind of know about this, and I feel like a year on is, I think that this is now the timing mark that we can talk about this. Now but I want to know where the hell that bear went.
I have to tell you,
that is so funny.
I didn't realize we were getting this high stakes. You know, I thought I was asking an innocent question, and now I feel like national security issues. You know, this is crazy. I don't know. Sorry, go on, Kira.
No. I was actually just gonna say, what do you call it? I'm just still just completely confused why the person thought it was a good idea to like switch it at all.
Because like, they thought they had the okay. And in fairness, I also heard this person give the okay too, and multiple other people did too. So I think this was effectively the person who
I
said
might
it
do
was
that
okay,
in my workplace one day. Realize... I swap out my monitor and for the really nice ones I have at my work.
So the thing is, like, it was a plushie for a plushie trade. It
wasn't, take the Herman Miller's chair as well, Rich.
It was a plushie for a plushie trade. So that wasn't the big thing. And then effectively, it was just like, I think someone gave the okay when they didn't realize it wasn't okay. And then when they found out it was a problem, it was too late to fix it at that point. So, yeah, it was. Yeah.
Well, moving on from bear espionage. Yeah, Peter, what are you thinking?
Are we doing League of Legends for later?
No, anything. I just chose to make it League of Legends.
I mean, I think because Nymeria, here I was thinking, you know, talk about Bronze Age collapse and things like this, but actually I've got a League of Legends related one that I've always wanted to know.
Here we go, yeah.
Okay.
Which is, why didn't Movie Star Riders make LEC franchise? Like, what, like, you hear lots of rumors, but in the initial LEC franchise,
yeah,
Movie Star Riders were like locked in until like the very, very last moment. And without going into too many details, like, there were a lot of people that I spoke to in that org, and like, it seemed like they would go in 100%. And
wait, I know the answer.
I think I do too. But
I'm
like,
pretty sure.
You don't know, and it's eating at you.
I think I do know the answer.
Maybe
I think,
right?
So I can't remember the exact order of things that happened, but basically, so Splat,
you're actually
for
getting
example,
the answer to the hypothetical question.
Exactly,
right,
possibly. So cool. This is going off memory from, I haven't thought about it in ages, so it could be wrong, but I remember, like, Splice weren't even meant to get in originally. They were like a standby team. And then there was, what was that Counter-Strike org called? The North, or North and something, someone else. Yeah. And then Movistar, yeah. I believe the reason that Movistar didn't get in was to do with the naming rights of the sponsor, Movistar. Yeah, and Riot had a problem with that. And initially,
was it a clashing sponsor or something?
It wasn't a clashing sponsor, but there was a hard and fast rule about having a sponsor as a name. That obviously, there's a big palaver about this with TSM and like the FXT stuff, and then Liquid being allowed Honda and so on. But at the time, I believe that they thought they were going to be able to move past it, and then Movistar kind of at the last minute is actually, no, we're not willing to compromise on this at all. Like, the team needs to be called Movistar, and Riot were like, well, no, then. And you're not allowed in if that's the name.
I have another thing too, because obviously we now have, I think it's Movistar R7 now as well, right? That's their sponsor, right? So yeah. That's the thing there. So obviously the LA team that was playing today. As far as I'm aware, because I've heard this from people who've talked to the players, and I'm fairly sure this is not, I don't think they've said this in secrecy. I think this is said in interviews. R7 are the most successful org in all like LLA history. Apparently they haven't been invited to Americas as of yet next year. They actually don't know if they're going to get in or not. So obviously you're planning to, like, are you playing next year? They actually don't know if they're even there next year. So that's another Movistar related thing. Far as I'm aware, they don't know if they're in there or not yet. They haven't been invited just yet.
I will say there's lots of, you know, will they, won't they be in, going on in all the regions at the moment, which I'm sure we'll talk about at a future point, but I don't really want to cuck any journalists out there who are currently working on it. So good luck all in the race to publish that one. But yeah, Kira, what one are you throwing out there? Something league related, something grander?
I want to know who's balancing Dota these days. I want their names. I want I want their fucking, who they are at Valve. I might even want their addresses at this point, by the way, because you think you are going through a tough time in League of Legends. You have no idea what I've got to experience. I'm going to picture this, people. Picture this. Talia, but her stones permanently rotate around her wherever she moves. And then she can ult in any direction, 3 times the length of screen. And she also auto-stuns you if you walk in. Permanently. And she never runs out of mana. That is the standard right now in Dota. And if you lose lane to them, you get flamed. That's what I'm experiencing right now. I don't know who gave the okay in this. I don't often justify violence, but it's getting pretty close. And also, oh, here's the best one. Bans are randomised as well in Dota right now. So you actually can't target ban specific champs. You have to elect 4 bans, and they might get banned randomly going into the game.
What? One thing I do know about Dota, or at least...
Right, that's what I'm experiencing right now.
is that the International had an incredibly low compendium this year compared to
That's 2 years that's happened.
Oh, it's because 2 years.
There's nothing in the compendium except from stickers that you can stick onto your profile rather than like in-game items and cosmetics. Okay,
but yeah, it's really affected the prize pool of the International, and it's been like the lowest it's been
Adjusted for inflation, this TI was worse than the first one.
Yeah. Jesus. Yeah, and the first one was like just over a million, I believe, at the time. Yeah. And the last one was like 2.4 or something like that.
That doesn't matter. That's for pros who are making money from playing the game, Reg. What about poor Keir, who's got to play solo queue when he actually can't ban specific picks? I want their names. I'm done.
I do have two non-gaming ones. Either the location. So this is like a really this is like the holy grail of Egyptology, Cleopatra's tomb. The location of it would be huge to know, because that'd be huge for like a whole load of archaeological stuff. And then also because
before Alexander, I'm disgusted.
Alexander, yeah, that's the one I was.
That's more like because Cleopatra. Well, because this was. Yeah, the Cleopatra one, the tomb is likely to be even more magnificent due to the era of it as well. Yeah, I mean, the tomb of Alexander
is,
but there is actually an ongoing search for this. Apparently, it's now potentially submerged off the north coast. Mm-hmm. And there is a search for it. It's just really hard for them to do underwater search to that point. Yeah. There have been a couple of sunken cities found already, obviously, because changing tides. And then the other one, because we already know how to make it, but we don't know how they used to make it. The original recipe and method to make Greek fire. I think that'd be like such an interesting thing to know. How did people come up with Greek fire? Because we can recreate it. We just don't know exactly how they made it back then. I think that'd be just really
question.
Cool to know
kind of angle, isn't it more? Wouldn't it be more interesting to know like how they built the pyramids? Wouldn't that be more interesting?
Aliens. It's fine. We know that. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Sure. Why
Just for people that don't know, like the Alexandrian sea line has coastline eroded. has gone south by quite a lot.
Great traveling exhibit which goes between museums around the world, which is called the Sunken Cities, which does go into two Egyptian cities which are on the north coast. They have some really rare finds there. Like there's one thing which is really cool, which actually would be another fun thing to know, a lot of Egyptian mythology is not written down because the Egyptians thought that by talking about something and writing it, it loses power. So there are many things that was passed down by word of mouth, but that means a lot of their mythology is still actually quite vague because we don't know all of it. But there was basically a funeral barge, which is a big part of their mythological kind of like celebrations and stuff like that, which was rebuilding basically a funeral barge of Osiris. And they would take a year to build this, and they would sail it down the Nile up until up to the Mediterranean each year. And they found one of these in these sunken cities. They actually have one of like this huge kind of very spiritually important object to ancient Egyptians, which is found sunk beneath there. So there's a load of stuff like that, which would be really cool, which is as of yet unknown.
That would be cool. I think with that kind of stuff, I'd more like go on the nose rather than like the more sort of niche-y stuff. Like, if Atlantis was actually based on anything, or if that was also just like a word of mouth, like, you know, Mauritania to Greece to whatever, or if it was actually real.
I really
cool
like Peter's suggestion of the Bronze Age collapse and the sea people and stuff like that too. That would actually be really
cool. Yeah, that would be
like,
very cool.
What actually caused the Bronze Age collapse? Was it actually everything all at once, as we suspect? But, you know, was there one particular reason? It'd be really cool.
Was there like an Attila or a Genghis Khan that we don't know, you know? They're leading all of these guys.
I think I'd actually probably go for the pyramids one, though, just purely because I think that would tell us so much about like how like monolithic structures in general, like we still don't know like at all. It is basic guesswork and water plus rolling logs, like, which explains about 2% of it. Like, yeah, brilliant. But anyway, right, we should probably move on to all things esports.
Covered a lot there. Yeah,
when are we going to get a world-class Greek team? That's what I want to know. When's the next great Greek team?
I mean, the best free agent on the market is a Greek player, no?
We'll not get into that.
Yeah, Lavrov's a free agent.
Yeah, no, you're right. You're right about both of those statements, Peter. I am the best agent by a mile, and Lavrov is basically the faker of support, isn't he? Really? So, right. Anyway, let's talk. It's really weird. I always forget that Lavrov's Greek, like temporarily, and I'm like, is he talking about comp?
All pro voters don't. They didn't. They always
true, very true. As the Swiss stage is starting, it's also time to get into the big boy bets. Okay, none of this mamby pamby, you know, $20 here, $20 there, malarkey, Kira. We're getting serious now. I need to start by informing the good people about this beautiful little winner's hedge bet that I put on, because I honestly, I couldn't really believe this, because I know I said, okay, before LCK finals, I said that Gen G, I didn't really think about it, you know, I was probably, this is wrong, but I was like, I reckon they've got about a 70% chance of winning Worlds. That's obviously going too far, like against the field, but I felt that there was probably a greater than 50% chance that they win Worlds. That was my feeling that I had. It wasn't scientific, it wasn't mathematical, it was just a feeling. After they lost to Hanwha, it didn't really change that much, but obviously it did dampen, you know, it brought me back to reality that, you know, they can be beaten. BLG could beat them. Hanwha could beat them again, though I think it's unlikely. But for me, when I saw that they were just under fours to win, I was like, I have to have it. And I don't just have to have it. I have to put $115 on it, which was the maximum amount for whatever reason it would let me put on it. So I've gone big, as you can see on the right there, at 3.75. One, I don't know why it's just under. I think it's to do with, like, I don't know, whatever. Anyway, I put 115 on. It says 114.81, whatever. So that returns 430 if that comes in. Now, I do believe, and you can balance this however you want. I'm sure Kira will give me his thoughts on this in a second. But I do believe that the odds of Gen G or BLG winning are definitely over 50%. For my mind, like, one of those two teams, like, I think these are two very strong favorites. Whoever you have, like, whatever, we could argue that. I think there's a greater than 50% chance that one of those teams win Worlds. So, because I believe in Gen G, that's where I put the big boy bet. But I still put a fairly big boy bet at $50 on BLG, because as you will see from the magic of mathematics here, I win either way. If one of those two teams wins, I get back what I bet, and I'm making money on top either way. So what do you think of this philosophy, Kira? Do you like it? Do you like these bets?
It's not how I would always bet, Rich, but, you know, 50% plus 50% equals 100%.
Exactly. There's no,
is there a way we can lose here? Is there a way we can lose?
Impossible.
Who knows?
Impossible. Just watch fucking T1 now do one of their stupid runs and just knock them both out and then lose themselves or something stupid. But by the way, do you prefer BLG to Gen G? Like, who do you actually have as favourite?
I think Gen G are favourites versus the field. But I think Billy Gaming actually has good matchups versus the teams that could beat Gen G. Like, I think Gen G has, like, poor matchups into, like, TES, because they're a bot lane team, and that's, like, one of the ways to, like, kill them. And I think they've got, like, a somewhat of a poor matchup. Or can have, like, a poor matchup into Tier 1, depending on what the bot lane meta is going to, like, chalk out, and also it's going to be a mage meta. Not in terms of form of teams, but in terms of, like, where the meta could go. And I think BLG matches up maybe better versus those two. But I think against everyone else, Gen G just annihilates them. And it's also the way they win. I think BLG could go to, like, Game 5s and Game 4s a lot of time against a lot of teams, where I don't think that would be as often for Gen G.
And also, ignoring, like, the specificity of this betting strategy that I've employed here, if you guys believe, like I do, that this Gen G team is one of the greatest League of Legends teams of all time, just forget the BLG side plot thing. The idea that they're, like, just under 4-1, that is crazy to me. Like, that is like a Samsung team, you know, be like Samsung White being, like, at 4-1 or something. Like, I think you just have to, like, I don't know. To me, that they are, if anything, undervalued. I mean, in actuality, they won't be, you know, because the odds will always be.
The LCK one seed is a bit cursed, where I think only Damwon won from first.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. But,
Can Gen G join the pantheon of teams?
I'm not a narrative man, Kira. You know, I don't believe in narratives. In fact, I actively disbelieve in... I am a non-believer in narratives. So there we go. But anyway, so what additional bets do we like here? Because we had a little look-see, and most of these best of one games that are coming up, the individual odds for straight up wins aren't great, but do you like anything here?
So the only two that I think there's, like, to ascertain some level of value is the double Western upset of Team Liquid and Fnatic together, back-to-back upsets on LNG and D plus Kia. Now, again, this is in the same line of reasoning and thinking as the PSG bet and the 100 Thieves bet and all those bets, where it is not the fact that it is likely to happen, it is that fact that versus the odds of it happening, the odds, I think the odds are close to or slightly under where they should be materialistic, and so I think there's value to be found in here. I don't actually think both these teams in a BO1 blind going in are that like unlikely to win both of these matches. Now, the problem is both of these teams have just dealt in loads and loads of close games. I'm not showing a lot of propensity to close out lot of games.
If you could bet on both of these games being super close, however you would calculate that, it's a slam dunk. It's a slam dunk. But
so you could possibly in some of these games vote with the specialty betting, like, you know, the towers or a number of dragons in the game or stuff like that. But I think we should keep it pretty simple. I think TL Fnatic, the double bet.
Yeah.
And then the other one where I think, and this is the one that's the closest to reality, I think Weibo to beat Gen G. However, I'm not all too sure about this one. And you might need to, you know, hold hands with me here on this one, Rich, about this. Because I think Weibo's odds maybe don't quite reflect how unlikely it is and under the strength of Gen G.
Right, so here's the logic here, right? So
hit me.
The logic is, so I'm just going to lock in this bet for the double upset. We're getting just under 12 to 1, which I'm not like massively happy about, I'm not going to lie. But apart from anything else, it's a fun bet, you know? It is a fun bet. They play back to back, so you'll know very soon. We're going to chuck 50 on that. Why not? Because that returns almost $600. So yeah, why the fuck not? So yeah, we're gonna put that on Liquid and Fnatic. We believe in the West. You got to. And yeah, so when
not
it comes
that much,
to,
but just a little.
Hey, we're it's the meat of worlds now. So we're doing meaty bets. That's how it works. But yeah, so with Gen G and Weibo, here's the logic. Okay, and keep in mind, I just gave this whole spiel about how Gen G are like massive favorites to win everything, blah, blah, blah. But new patch, haven't played in a while. And Weibo, even though there's this weird, unpredictable, disjointed mess like the KT of the LPL, etc., 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 that works into their favor here because of all the sort of unknowns and the variables and the time off. And the fact, the bottom line is, they have really fucking good players. They have a world-class top laner in a particular way, in his own way. They have a world-class jungler. They have a, not so much as consistently these days, but still a world-class mid laner on his day. And they have a great fucking AD carry as well. You know, I'm not the biggest fan of Crisp, I'm not gonna lie, but there's so much talent here, and in a BO1, why the fuck not? Why the fuck not? So we're going Weibo Gaming. We're going again 50. We're putting 50 on, and we get 200 back if they do win that. So, oh, please. Oh, I put it on combo. Remember, kids, change it from single to combo when you're not doing an accumulator. That was my first mistake. So there we go. 50 on Weibo Gaming to beat Gen G. At worst, K-Draw will be happy, won't he? So
just to run through them all, I give a quick like narrative piece just because they're all in front of me right here. I think PSG Talon, the upset chances against Hamwa aren't all that good. I don't think PSG showed enough in play-ins to bet them. If they had shown better strength in play-ins, there could have been value here, Rich, in this bet, just in terms of the upset potential, but I don't think it was there whatsoever. They've got a lot to prove. I think I would be avoiding that. I think if you believe in GAM upsetting NA, I think there's value to be said here with GAM. Not that it is like super likely, but it's a BO1. Inspired is really, really important part of FlyQuest. Cat it into like Bwipo. You know what I mean? There is a lot to be said that like, GAM could possibly find the upset potential. I am not, again, I actually think GAM did show strength in plans. I think if you, and I, again, as I said beforehand with GAM, and if you do like believe in them, I do think there's a lot there. Pain versus G2, I think Pain's bot lane, they showed up a lot of like upside, but against G2, again, that could just be like a complete like nightmare scenario. I don't think Pain show, again, they're kind of in the same bracket as PSG Talons, but to a lesser extent, but then against a worse opponent, so it's all relative. I don't think their price matches what it needs. I think Mad Lions is way off. I think the Mad Lions price here is not worth it in value, unless you're like some diehard Mad Lions fan and you believe in the angle of like the draft and the prep Even then, I think they were super messy in their fight selections. BLG will eat those fights up for days. They will handshake you on all of those and meet you in better. We just watch Mad Lions upset BLG and just piss in my face. I think there is some value, and because T1 of the mass amount of people that bet T1, their price never reflects how good they are as an actual team. Even if they are like the best team, then the price is way off. And even if they're like a terrible team, so many people will be betting them that their price is like way. But the good thing is here, you've got Top Esports at two odds. If you think, you know, Top Esports have like EWC was the last time we've seen these teams rich, wasn't the prettiest for Tian, but it's not a playoff scenario. You know what I mean? The best we've seen of Top Esports was in the league stages. You know, the BO3 stage, the BO1 stage, the group stages of tournaments, that's where they look the best. So if you like Top Esports, I don't think this 2.0 bet is out of the ordinary. If you see, again guys, live betting, if you see strong drafts, the jinx packs for ADCs, all of this type of stuff, you know, you can come in, do the live betting. It's really important. That's where the angles can be in these playing stages. You know what I mean? You come in here, you see G2 have fallen behind Pain Gaming, but they've got the scaling comp. You come in, you bring in the live bets. These are the type of things where you can find really good price and angles. We've already talked about Team Liquid and Fnatic, where I think they're the closest to reality, where I think if Team Liquid and Fnatic play four times, I think they win about one. So that's why we're going to take it as like a double to just see if we can hit the high roll of it both, them both happening on the same day. And then Weibo Gaming Gen G we've already talked about.
Yeah. Gamble responsibly. Never bet what you can't afford. And remember that with Thunderpick, as long as you deposit at least 20 euros, they will double whatever you deposit up to a value of 600. Of course, if you use my beautiful code at the top there, Rich's Wrath. So yeah, and also for whatever reason you're just struggling to access the site for some reason, take a holiday, you know, maybe go to Germany. I hear you can get there very quickly. Right, so yeah, let's talk about play-ins. We won't waste any time on the teams that didn't make it, other than 100 of Thieves, because they deserve to have their own, we'll call it a eulogy, but it might be more of sort of a grave robbery scenario with what these people deserve based on that gameplay. But we'll see. But let's start with the teams that did make it. So let's start with our good old boys, Mad Lions. I would actually probably say overall they slightly exceeded expectations. I think there was some negativity around them being the third seed for like some fair-ish reasons, but also not particularly fair, because I think when it mattered, they put in the performances that warranted getting the third seed. I also think they had a couple of standout performers during play-ins, Alvaro being an obvious one. Super also had a lot of really good moments. So yeah, Peter, what were your sort of expectations of Mad going in, and how do you feel about them now before Swiss?
So I don't really want to be contrarian, but actually I thought Mad kind of underperformed my expectations. Like I thought Mad would, because we're against playing teams, right? Look at who they played against. They had a 2-0 series against Vikings, who frankly, you know, their top laner. if half of the, or three quarters, how many of the VCS got banned? Like 50%?
About half, just under.
About half. Yeah. Like, I mean, this guy isn't coming anywhere near VCS team. If half the league doesn't get removed. So they won 2-0 against this team, and then they won a very, very shaky 2-1 against PSG. And I'm going to be honest, like Super was, Alvaro was insane. I think Alvaro was probably the best player in play-ins.
Yep.
Super, I think, had some kind of limit testing moments where he got caught in really, really awkward situation, which...
Did it have to do with River and Ziggs?
Well, yeah. But I mean, to be fair, credit to him for playing Ziggs, right? Because this is not the kind of champion that Super would play historically, and he's developed it and put it in his pool. So, you know, fair enough. But, you know, I've been really disappointed by Illyria and by Frascari at the store.
Frascari's been rubbish.
But it's not that I think they're being outskilled. I think it's just, like, the pressure. They're not playing as aggressively as they did. And you think about Mad Lions, you can say a lot of things about Mad Lions. You can say maybe that they're not, maybe they're predictable, maybe they like, don't have the best hands, you know, I'm not saying I think these things. I'm saying that this is criticism people have put at Mad Lions. But one thing you would never say about Mad Lions is that they lack decisiveness and that they don't have early game plans, right? They always have really good early game plans. They're always mega decisive. And even if the play is bad, they will force it as fire. And at this tournament, they haven't done that. And they've relied on individual outplays, mainly from Alvaro, a little bit from Super, a little bit from Illyria. But, you know, for me, I think Merwin is like one of their most important players. And I don't think they beat G2 without Merwin having like that absurd performance he did in playoffs, which is what got them to Worlds in the first place. And I think that Frescari a lot and Merwin have been like below my expectations, but I'm sure they'll be fine going into the group stage.
I just have one question for you before I ask the other guys. But you say that they perform below your expectations overall, and I think you made like a lot of cogent points. But going into the PSG game, did you expect them to beat PSG? Because I think most people didn't. I think the consensus was that PSG were probably the best team in play-ins. How did you feel about that? Did you expect Mad to beat them?
So before the tournament, before Worlds, yes. After seeing the Vikings game, I was a bit more shaky. But yeah, I still thought that they were going to win. But basically, this play-ins, and we'll talk about some of the other teams later, but like a lot of this has been down to nerves and mental fortitude. I feel like so many teams were really, really panicking in this play-ins. And I will be clear, like on that third game, obviously Alvaro had an insane third game against PSG, but Junjia had like one of the worst games. Like I've been watching this guy for years, and he's just like, Flash? Garner ulting Alistar?
I've actually heard of it. There's a really funny kind of like reference going around that he's the TN of play-ins where he just like disappears despite potentially being the best jungler in that stage of the tournament. And I found that quite telling. Because yeah, I thought he should be the best player in play-ins, but he definitely wasn't.
But I mean, Nymera, what did you think? Because I think the consensus was most people had PSG favored going into that. I don't think Mad.
Yeah,
were...
I mean, pre-tournament, I was really high on PSG. I think a lot of people were too. What up?
But what about PSG's own meta read going into... And like, because you got to also see PSG versus Pain Gaming, and PSG didn't look good versus Pain Gaming, and their meta read was like infinitely worse than Mad's, right? And so when I seen that, even though I agree with Peter that like Mad versus Vikings wasn't the best ever, I was actually more concerned for PSG, because PSG looked like an absolute... a pile of shit versus Pain, to be honest. Because I thought PSG were a team that could potentially take games off of lower seeded, major region teams in the BO1s, and technically they did because they took a game off of Mad Lions. But I was not impressed with their Pain, and it's nothing against, by the way, Pain Gaming. I just think PSG's like meta read and their picks and like their counter picks and their draft prio were all over the place. It was really, really poor for me. To be honest, a lot of Mad Lions draft, I actually really liked it. I thought they were all like pretty good.
Yeah.
Across the board, to be honest.
Yeah.
I predicted Mad to be, because all my predictions are public. And I'm doing this like thing, yeah. So I predicted them to win 2-1. But like.
Fair enough. Then. There we go.
Ever heard of Thunder Pick, Peter? Sounds like you got an eye for this stuff.
I was really high on PSG before the tournament. Seeing them play in PCS, they looked really, really good. I think, obviously, we're not going to talk about the Hawks as much because they completely fucking bombed it.
Yeah.
I think both PCS teams had horrible meta reads. Horrible meta reads. And I think there's something which... There were some things which I've heard in some kind of conversations around... Some of the teams in play-ins had such bad meta reads, even from the scrims that they were having, they didn't even think, they weren't prepared for lane swaps. So as soon as Mad showed those lane swaps in the first day of play, a lot of people freaked the fuck out. They were only practicing against lane swaps for a couple of days, in some cases. It was been really, really bad. And I think that PCS has had, in some international tournaments before, some pretty slow meta reads. I was surprised it affected, well, obviously Hawks to a huge extent, but PSG to a huge extent too, actually, as well, in terms of the way that they can't play fast games anymore. They are very, very slow. I felt like going against Mad, it still was a close series, actually, in a lot of places. You know, we can talk about, you know, the crazy Alistar headbutt onto Maple, but also that was Maple misplaying that. You never get into flash Q range of an Alistar. That's the one way you lose that game, and he did that, and he failed that play. I think there were some big individual underperformances from that, and of course Junja had some really bad games. There was my personal favorite game was the game they lost against Pain, where he built Heartsteel on Skarner and got one Heartsteel proc in a 31-minute game. It was awful. One of the worst games I've seen from an individual jungler for a while. So, compared to my expectations, PSG took blow after blow from all of these games and individual performances and stuff like that, and it was still a 50-50-ish series with Mad. Actually, I think that that third game probably should have been PSG winning, given the lead that I had on Corki throughout most of that game. Yep. And it took a couple of quite huge throws. I still think that MAD deserved to go through over PSG at that timestamp. I think that MAD had better drafts. They were the ones pulling out the lane swaps, and as we said, that really spooked a lot of other teams. By the way, I don't think that lane swaps should have ever been considered to be totally gone anyway. I said this on Twitter
It's an absolute disgrace, maybe, isn't it?
I actually find it really quite concerning that a lot of people said that lane swaps are gone when people saw that towers were harder to kill. Lane swaps are not just about tower gold. It can be about protecting an early lane. It can be, I mean, LS quotes who he did my tweet and said, look, it is a guaranteed mid game on a champion in bot lane for you. That is that is worthy of its own strategy. And now, it might not be for every draft, might not be for every game, but it does have value. You have added bonuses of occasionally making the enemy jungler slip up because they didn't see it coming. They start on the wrong camp. They path wrong. That can be a big mistake for them. Sometimes mid lane can get left out to dry because they don't realize it's happening early enough too. And then they can mess up their wave state. They can leave themselves open to someone roaming across sides of the map, stuff like that. There's plenty of value if you can maximize it. And obviously, team like MAD had prepared that well. I think that Elgoya orchestrated that well in their first series. We didn't see swaps in the MAD series, did we? I'm trying to remember. I know that PSG swapped today when they played today, but against MAD, I think it was more standard lanes, if I can remember that correctly. PSG potentially wanted to swap with the UD game. That was it. They wanted to maybe do it with the UD game, but I don't think they did that much with it. I think they predicted a swap and then they did the other thing. I think the biggest thing for me is that MAD had a much better meta read coming in terms of draft and in terms of early game strategies. I do actually think PSG on the whole had some better individual performances across the board, but they also had some really weird ones too, as we've been saying from Junja and like that odd moment from Maple or the like. So I think both these teams ended up being quite a similar level. I think both of them underperformed for me compared to pre-tournament expectations. I thought both of them were coming a little bit stronger, either on individual level from MAD, because I think Frescovi, it's a mage meta. I've always preferred him on mages compared to AD mids. I remember his Azir and his Victor very well from when he was winning in the Masters. He was very powerful at those. So I was quite surprised to see him perform quite poorly in some points on stuff like the Vex or the Syndra, which he played in that game 2 loss against MAD. I'm hoping that both of them can shape up a little bit more. Plains is obviously going to be a very different meta to Swiss stage as well. I still think they both deserve to go through, but I think that shows the level of play-ins definitely took a hit in terms of prep coming into this tournament. I was quite surprised by how uncomfortable some teams were at kind of adapting from the summer patch and the summer meta to Worlds.
Sure. I think also on the lane swap thing, like, the people are thinking about this completely the wrong way, right? Like, the reason why lane swaps are still viable is because giving up that gold doesn't actually matter because snowballing the game from 14 to 20 minutes. Like, normally the amount of gold that you're going to lose, the time where you will feel that gold loss is between the 14 to 20 minute mark, right? And it's really hard to add more things to snowball into the game in that time slot. So you having that gold means that you'll be a little bit behind on your item, but as long as you hit your second and third item pass bikes at the same time, you're still gonna be fine, right? And you can't like lose the game before you hit 3 items unless you choose to fight, right? And that's why I think the lane swaps are really, really strong. And like you said, it has nothing to do with the tower, right? We'll have to see. I think we'll still see it more at Worlds coming later. And I think it will make a big difference because it will make things like Xayah maybe in the meta. Maybe we'll see more Jinx in the meta, which is good for Manlands, obviously, right?
Moving forward. Now, both of these teams obviously have incredibly difficult opening Swiss games. We won't get too much into the matchups. I'll just ask you, Kira, this. What are you hoping to see from like both teams as sort of, I guess, a development or evolution when PSG, for example, they play HLE, MAD obviously play BLG. I'm not saying, we expect them to win, but what would you like to, would you like to see these teams?
MAD have to lane swap. They can't give, okay, Merwin was a disgrace and not like he was an individual disgrace and plans. Like he was all over the place. He was playing very, very poorly and creating a lot of net negative loss situations for his team that didn't actually it was basically just his inputs that were like creating it in my opinion. Like he was not playing like his like best League of Legends. I don't think Frescovi was as well, but I think a lot of people kind of got a little bit too high on Frescovi because of like the playoff stage at the end where he was like beating caps in lane and solo killing caps and stuff like that. Like the idea of like that trend line and through line like continuing wasn't all too realistic. He's kind of showed like a streakiness to him in the LEC to his level, and so this was somewhat more where I consider him. Though like picking the right things right now in League of Legends is like half the battle, and him showing the ability to actually pick the Renekton, even though it might be one of the worst mid lane Renektons like ever seen. Yeah. Like no, but it is what it is. It's like even the worst Ivern I've ever seen is still Ivern.
True.
Like when you pick Renekton in those types of situations, the principle can be better than the play. Like he ints top lane, Maple hits him with three consecutive rounds of Akali spells, goes to ult him, and Frescovi still has 600 health left. And so it's like it's the difference in execution just by picking the correct things is like it makes the game so much easier to play. So what do they need? You know, I think Mad Lions need to prep lane swaps. Feeding Merwin to Ben does not seem like a good idea to me.
Wait. But on red side, they're going to be on red side, and Merwin normally has like really good cheese counterpicks, no?
I don't believe in any cheese against Ben.
I think like, Ben's probably like the best individual laner in the world. This guy
If it was 369, you can cheese him. Adam cheesed 369 a couple of years ago with Garen. 369 should have lost GDG that game against
Oscar.
Last year, right? Okay, but the problem is I agree, they're going to get to cheese, but like, Ben can pick Gnar into like so many matchups that like on paper should be like losses, and he just wins them at such a consistent rate that like you're just running the numbers. If he preps something, know what? See if Merwin does prep something and he gets off, I'll fucking applaud him to high heavens because he's done something that almost nobody could do this year. So he can join a gallery of first. But I think what's even more dangerous is the bot lane, because if you run the bot lane into BLG with Wei, I don't know. Unless they leave Nidalee up in terms of like Eagle and they get the Nidalee like dual flex, so they get the counter pick on lane and like El Yoya onto Nidalee as well into like Wei, and they hard accelerate with that. Into Wei. I don't know. I'm really like, even as good as like Super and Alvaro like have kind of become during like play-ins, and they were like the highlight on Mad Lion. The 2v2 versus BLG, I don't think that's a good idea. And Midland's going to go to shit. Like, Frescovi's going to be playing against Knight. So, and
I have one thing to throw in here as well, because I've had obviously, I've had problems with a particular champion in play-ins, if this is ever going to focus. I've had my girl back in meta again, Ahri. No one knows how to early lane on her anymore, because no one knows how to use Electrocute W level 1 to play against mages. You have to play ballsy, and you can control that lane. I think that if you give a volatile matchup to mid lane, whether that's Ahri or whether it's Jace, Syndra, I think that Knight is arguably the best Syndra of all time on Showmaker. That could actually... Lane swaps don't save mid lane. That's going to be a big problem, because I think that you
might be... But they can if he's free up jungle.
Even then, I think level 1, level 2 could actually go badly enough that it could literally fall apart. Fair enough. Because I think very highly of Knight on mages, even in a very earliest level. It's something that we've talked about a lot here in terms of how Knight kind of disregards his own HP pool to make plays like this. So look, I think regardless, effectively what we're doing is we're doing the Doctor Strange thing to try and find like what's the one route to success for Mad against BLG. They are all of the teams that are quote-unquote outclassed, and they are on an individual level, they're outclassed because BLG arguably tournament favorites based on meta, that they're definitely sure. They're on the list. Of the teams that could take a disadvantageous player matchup, they're the team which I trust maybe the most to have a strategy somehow cooked up to make it more even. I just think that BLG are on such another level compared to almost any other team in the world. They're in, you know, I think there are three or four teams that probably are on mechanically the same level at the very top of the table. I think that even with the most advantageous strategies to come out with, I feel like one person getting ahead from BLG might just make it so hard for Mad to win. So it's a very hard draw for them, but this is maybe their hardest draw because there are so many lanes which can diff them.
I mean, but okay, so first thing, if they play like they did in play-ins, like there's zero chance. Like, it doesn't matter what they play, it doesn't matter what they pick, right? But I think that in play-ins, they're under more pressure because they're expected to win and they know that they are going to get shit on by everyone.
Oh, true. Underdog both, yeah. I can see that.
So I think maybe that will help them be a bit more relaxed. They also have the play-in, they also have stage practice, they're also going to have the crowd behind them.
So they're also going to be on a different meta because they were playing play-ins meta and all the LPL teams came in from their own scrim bubble. That could be that could actually technically work in their favor.
You didn't look convinced because, like, for example, there's a chance Merwin just goes in, picks Kassante into, because they think Kassante's the best pick. He picks Kassante into Ben and Ben just, and the early pick Kassante and Ben just gets to early, like, do like Gnar, Renekton, Jax, like any sort of like things. There's an entire chance that they don't go for that counterpick and they don't agree with our assessment.
No, that firstly that's not going to happen, right? Like it's just not going to happen. And like what's going to happen is they're going to fifth pick top, or they're going to fifth pick. I don't think you gain a benefit from fifth picking mid right now. They're going to fifth pick top, and they're going to give like something. Maybe they even give Jax if they're crazy enough, right? Like, and he goes and plays like Alistar. No, Alistar's not like, you know, he plays Gragas. I don't know, right? I don't know what they're going to do, right? And overthinking this is like is not going to really get anywhere. Like maybe he plays like Varus or Cassiopeia.
That's what I was thinking. Maybe I could see. I actually could see Merwin trying to play something like Varus and just being like, it's so good in lane that maybe I can like somehow neutralize the Bing X factor. Like I honestly could actually see that. Also, when better to do it than now, when you're so mismatched, you have to take a chance. If you're mad, you can't be safe
here.
Like picking Cassandre would just be suicide.
Also, one thing too as well, which is important with all of these matches, and I'm sure this will apply to the other ones too, you can't rematch against the same team later in Swiss. I believe I'm pretty sure you can't do that.
BLG out of the way.
So if BLG somehow get knocked to not like the perfect straight up and they go to one more and Mad have like some easy draws in the next rounds, they can't face BLG again. There is a chance that they can meet them at like 1-1 if BLG play against, I don't know, like one of the really good teams in round one and they have a really good meta read. At least they get this one out the way. So that's a bonus.
Yeah.
So here's the other one, Rich. PSG, because you asked. Yeah. Okay. But it's actually quite simple for PSG. I think they need to adapt really fast off of their pick prio. I think they need to move off of where they are. I think they need to like get like back on course. I actually think at PSG need to be one of the teams that need to try do the like draft, like one of the draft tactics. I don't know what you'd call it, like Peter. I'm gonna just say it like verbatim, where basically you leave all the like a group of the OPs up and you like trade them.
Overloaded drafts. Yeah.
You overload drafts. Like you just leave a bunch of the OPs up rather than banning them all, and you like split them to like try and get like things like Jinx and Ziggs and stuff like that. Because where they're at right now, it doesn't suit Maple, which even though Maple's not as good as he was in previous iterations, he's still like a large part of the team identity, and they need to get Junja onto not better comfort, but Junja needs to basically just play better. I know that's such like a fucking thing.
Junja needs to remember that he has hands, right?
And yeah, that was such a shit thing for me to say on this show, but it really, there's so much to talk about of like how bad Junja like was and how much better like he needs to be. It's like, yeah, he needs to like assign to lanes like better. He needs to like accelerate winning matchups better. He needs to like team fight, target selection better.
We talked to PSG a lot in the lens of the Mad Koi series, which makes sense. They played really well today though. Like they played really well today. So at least there is an argument where I think it is, you have to mention this, PSG. I think that they can be a very good team. I think they have a lot of potential. They probably, hopefully will ramp up, and now they're in Swiss. They are now back on that same stage where they could be a threat, but they need to prove they can ramp the way back up to the form that we saw in PCS regionals.
I mean, I've got a question here. Do you think it's more likely Mad will win or will win their series, or do you think it's more likely PSG will win their series? Because to me, I think Mad are more likely to be PSG.
Really?
And I don't think it's high for either team. I don't think it's high for
PSG
team,
versus HLE is some hellish nightmare shit, by the way. Like, it is. That is actually, like, such a bad matchup for PSG with the way they're playing right now. Right, put it this way, Peter, right? If we go down the line of reason where Merwin can get out of, like... Nah, but look, you know why it isn't, Peter? Because I would actually have to see Mad Lion do the Merwin thing first, and I'm not even sure they will. I've not got as much faith in them as you do.
I think when it's in best of ones, I would agree, because look, BLG, I push back heavily because I've heard on this one statement which I've heard, which is that BLG are messy and they're imprecise. No, they play a style which leads to some openings in their play, because they're very opportunistic and they're very reactive. They react very well to someone getting ahead of the game, but they don't follow a flowchart. They improvise quite well on the fly. HLE and teams like, I don't know, LNG and the more LCK style of play tend to be a lot more rigid in the way that they play in terms of very straight win conditions and playing to particular resets and stuff like that. I think in a best of one setting, there is a chance that one of these openings benefits Mad if they're quick enough to seize that opportunity. I think in a best of one, I'd agree with that. So think of the more games you play, the more that BLG's pure skill and their ability to just kind of like weave their way through uncertain situations comes alive. So I think a best of one. Yeah, no, I think actually, no, Peter, I think you're on the money there in terms of in a best of one format, I would agree. It's probably easier to upset a Chinese team than it is a Korean team on the whole. I think
Mad Lions have, let me think about a way of phrasing this. I think that Mad Lions can have maybe a 10 to 15% chance which I think for most people will think is outrageously high. But I don't actually think it's outrageous. I think that they can actually win this. Whereas I think
a what HLA percent is, chance? Sorry, what percent did you give him?
10 to 15%, maybe 20%.
Okay, like now we're
Nightlocks in Syndra Ahri, 2% chance.
Okay, maybe 20%. 15.
No, yeah,
I'm gonna say. I'm gonna say 15%. 15% chance. Mad Lions have a 15% chance.
I think if I had to bet on one over the other, I would bet that PSG beats HLE. And here's my logic, right? And I'm not gonna say this is sound logic, because there is no sound argument in my opinion for either upset particularly. But the way I see it is like this: when you're dealing with heavy underdogs in this situation, I would rather go with the angle where you might reach the first key fight, whether it be around a Drake or whatever, or a team's just forced into a position where they have to take a fight, on sort of even standings versus how likely it is that they'll reach that point of the game being on even standings. When I see Knight and fucking Bin, like, in two of the three lanes, I'm already assuming when the first fight happens, unless something extraordinary goes on, that they're going to be behind when the first major team fight happens. If they can manage to, you know, suppress Peanut, which is possible because of the kind of jungler he is in this second half of his career, let's call it, and you don't have quite an oppressive top laner, you don't have quite, on certain picks at least, an oppressive mid laner from a laning perspective, let's say, depending on how it goes, I think it's more likely that PSG will enter the first major fight of their game closer in gold than Mad will in their game. And when it comes down to a fight, anything can happen. By the way, if they win that fight, they're still probably not going to be favoured to win the game unless they ace them and it's on 19 minutes, 50 seconds, so they get Nash off it. But I think it's more likely it'll be closer at that point.
I think also another big factor is the fact that you have way over Shun as well. I think that Shun is a player with very explosive highs, but obviously it can leave some big openings as well if you can upset him early sometimes. Way is a lot more stable. I think if Elioa has the game of his career, and you know that Elioa can be very, very good, maybe that upsets BLG enough. I just feel like it's very hard to run a whole game playing ton like that. As soon as BLG get one person ahead, they're very good at shifting focus to them and pulling the game off. So I think it's, look, either way, both of these, very, very difficult. I think Betty versus Viper, horrible for PSG in terms of that matchup too, because I think Betty is not the best individual AD carry like that too. So, we're spending a lot of time talking about the two matches.
I'm going to say one thing, okay? Just to put this, like, into their best, because, like, I've just, like, kind of picked up on the matchups and I've started to, like, go around them in my head, right, okay? You've got a lot of bans you're going to have to throw into mid lane. Like, you're going to have to, like, for example, either ban or pick away Yone. Like, guaranteed. You can't let Zeka play Yone in this meta. That's just a loss. He's arguably the best or second best Yone in the world. Third best if Cream can remember how to play it, some maybe. I don't know, like... No, he'd still be better than Cream, actually.
Look, it's doomed.
It seems so... I mean, it's doomed either way.
Both matchups are doomed.
It's not that they're doomed. It's just that they're very, very, very hard. And I would be really interested to see how the teams perceive their draft prep. Because I think a lot of it does come down into, like, draft prep and, like, your strategy prep of, like, are you going to lane swap? What picks are you going to, like, hide? What are you going to try and do? Because the only thing I can think for, like, Mad Lions, because BLG aren't, like, that good a drafting team, is if they end up with, like, the Jinx and Ziggs and stuff, and they can end up playing, like, they execute, like, reset comps and stuff like that, even though the one they played actually failed, but, you know, Elioa forgot to buy items. You know, there's something interesting to be said in there, but they did show the opportunity to play it, so...
I mean, anyway, let's move on. I think we probably know the results of both of those games, but it's fun.
But they are still best of ones.
Exactly. We'll anything can happen. Who knows? But yeah, so let's talk about a team from Brazil, which will brighten up Peter's day. We've got Pain Gaming, the mainstays. These guys have been around forever. And as Nymera, among other people, have referenced over time, this is still like a really important region in League of Legends. Like, no matter what Riot do to it with amalgamating leagues or whatever, like, it's always big and important, in my opinion, when a Brazilian team does make it to the main event, because there's just a lot of fan interest there. But yeah, I mean, on a fundamental level though, Peter, what do you think of Pain? Do you like how they've been performing so far? How are they meeting expectations?
So there's a lot of people that don't really watch CB Law, or maybe who just watch them in playoffs or things like this, and are saying things like, oh, you know, Pain looks so much better than they did in playoffs and things like that. No, this is the same Pain that has always been. Like here, Pain, what are Pain good at? Pain have good laning phase, Pain have good objective setup, Pain are creative in team fights, and they have a really, really strong AD carry. And actually, it's really funny because before this show, I did my team of the play-ins, and I put T-Tan, the AD carry for Pain over Super, and the mad point guys
see logic for that. Yeah,
are fucking angry about it, which I think is
shock.
I mean, they're
under what basis? Under what basis, Peter?
What?
Because
they think Super should be the best, and I think T-Tan should be the best, right? By the way,
I agree with you. I actually think T-Tan should be on there instead of Super. I actually think T-Tan had a hell of a series today.
I think T-Tan was insane, and I think even in the games where his score is bad...
Sorry, I thought you meant like from Brazilian playoffs. Sorry.
From planes, right? I mean, like to be clear, like I think T-Tan has like pushed his limits on like every single game. He had literally one... Okay, he had a bad like Lucian ult where he ulted in the wrong way in base when the game was basically over in game one, which was kind of bad. But I think like especially on his Ezreal, I remember he had an Ezreal game. I think it was the second game against PSG where they lost, where he was like literally solo keeping them in the game by like playing to his limits like every single fight. And I think this guy he's somebody that came into the scene when he was 16. He was like really, really talented, kind of like lost his way, I would say. Maybe enjoyed the side parts of being a pro maybe a little bit too much in the middle of his career, and has kind of like reached that maturity now, and is like has
I've
become
heard
a
so
a,
many stories about the random shit people do in Brazil. I'm not just referring to it. I'm pretty sure that gambling is banned in Brazil, but like there are ways you can go to casinos and stuff which players will just do because they will. Every day is Carnival, baby.
Actually, I'll just interject very quickly. I don't think gambling is banned in Brazil because I do know that you can play Thunder Pick from Brazil. So, you know, how do those two things coincide?
Things I've heard.
But in any case, I think I'm going to be really careful about this. I'm not saying that the same player, but I think that his career trajectory is a bit like UZI in that they came up really, really, really young, maybe too much fame too early, and then like by experiencing setbacks in their career, like he's now become a lot more mature, and he's become a lot better all-round player as we go. It's worth saying that Brazil, the one thing Brazil has is over other regions is that their ping on their servers is like 2. They have like a from Rio and from Sao Paulo, so they always have like mechanical. Like they can hold up with the Koreans because they just practice on 2 ping, right? Like compared to Europeans, you know, or North Americans. So their mechanics are always there. But let's be clear, like Pain, their rotations are really, really bad. They sometimes get lost on the map in the mid game, and sometimes they'll overcommit. Like they'll send 5 people to chase a single kill and lose like their entire advantage on the map. But make no mistake, these guys can team fight and they can. Their objective setup is good. Maybe they over prioritize objectives.
So, what would you think's their path to victory against G2, who they play in Swiss Peter? How would you see that? You know, wake up tomorrow, Pain won. How did they win?
Han Summer got food poisoning. I mean, I don't know. Like, I think G2 is like the worst. No, BLG is the worst. G2 are the same. Right? Like,
I think a big problem. So I think the one way I can see them potentially winning is if Mickey has an absolute nightmare laning phase, which he can sometimes do. If Mickey has a really bad 2v2 laning phase and like they disrespect T-Tan, this guy's always been the playmaking aggressive AD carry. So I think there's some leads they can get there. I have some real worries though, because Tinkedo had really, really bad laning phases, like really bad. I was sat there today. I live viewed the series today that they played, and his Ahri in lane versus Kena from Rainbow Seven, awful, genuinely awful. His decision making was really, really bad in the Ari versus LeBlanc matchup and stuff like that, where he was panicking quite a lot. We saw that even on his Yone. His Yone has not regionally been known as one of his best champions. In fact, it was kind of memed that it was one of his worst. But I think he looked better on that than he did on the Ari in laning phase. He's better in the mid and late game. I think he kind of switches on as the game goes through because he understands what his team's doing and stuff like that. But doing that kind of laning phase against Caps is a problem. So I think they need a non-volatile mid matchup or try and get Yone or something like that so we can just kind of survive through to mid game to be useful. And hope that Mickey has a really bad misunderstanding in TVT, which you can sometimes have. Get him onto a volatile lane, get him on something like Poppy, which can sometimes over-engage and die horribly, or play against, you know, I think Curry's Nami, fucking great, by the way. Curry really, really shine for me. I think Curry's good when he's on his game. I think when they took the game off of PSG, a lot of that was on Curry just massacring Junger in every fight. He would just CC up the Skarner, allow them to do nothing. So I think Payne have some limited snowball options where T10 gets an aggressive AD carry that can carry the game off of a lane lead. And that's kind of it. It's not a great
draw. Yeah, I agree. Also, Karriok has to, get out of it. I don't know what's been up, right? Maybe he's not sleeping well. Maybe, it's adapting to new environment. But he has not been good at this one. Bot lane and top lane have been good. Jungle mid have been really, really rough. And you cannot play a losing jungle mid into G2. It doesn't matter how good your bot lane are, right? And obviously Dinkedo is going to struggle into caps. It's just going to happen, right? It's just going to happen.
Peter, I have been informed by powers greater than me that Yike doesn't play carries and cannot carry, though he broke the damage record on carries in playoffs. Broken Blade, his top laner.
Oh, his Broken Blade says that he can't play carries. I mean,
cannot carry the game.
Okay, well.
Well, Broken Blade was being solo killed by Chex Notes, everybody, with counterpack, and every matchup, and lost every single matchup. Meanwhile, Yike broke the damage records on everybody. I've been informed that he cannot play carries, so unfortunately, what you have just said is not true.
One of the most annoying, narrative random thing. Well, it's not even narrative. One of the most annoying things to see happen to Yike in this team is that he has been, I think, overshadowed and a little bit cowed by just players on G2 being very, very good best in role, so he often defers to them. You know, when he first came into the team, it was Caps supporting him most of the time, and he would play more carry stuff. He'd play farming stuff and then Caps would roam over to his lane, over to him and get him a snowball to have. People who watched him back in ERLs obviously know Yike can do horrendous amounts of damage on any given situation if he's given that kind of space to do so. Apparently not. So yeah, I wonder whether we'll get a last hurrah of this kind of world in terms of this kind of start saying, okay, maybe we can get him back towards his carries as opposed to get a bit of a switch about.
Bring back the graves. Get him on that four quadrant dominance.
I want to see Yike Viego again, man. His Viego is legendary. So good.
But right. Let's talk about GAM, who are the fourth and final team to make it through. Now, Kira, you said that you don't really watch GAM, whatever. But for this world,
This is the only year I didn't watch GAM.
Because of
what happened in. I didn't find it interesting after the implosion of the region.
Yeah.
I made the executive decision to not watch GAM.
Yeah.
And I was mistaken. So, I should have kept watching GAM.
How are you liking them now? How are tasting?
The same thing, all of it, GAM. I love this team because they just live up to my adage. Know thyself. Do not pretend to be someone you are not. They know who they are and they actually play to the identity. That identity will only run them so far, but it will get you there. It has legs. And know what? Fuck, that's so good. It's so, they maybe had an easier draw in context than was maybe deserving, but you can, Riot decides the format and you can only play who's in front of you. And, you know, a lot of people are talking about, stuff like, Are they actually the best team? Maybe they're the second best team. Maybe they just won in playoffs because the other team. I think they quite clearly showed that they are at this point in time in the league. You know, that could have been true at playoffs, that they are quite clearly the best Vietnamese team. I think, it's always a pleasure to see them, represent Vietnam. I think they have. And when people see something that is bad, by the way, they always use this word style instead of using the word horseshit or it's terrible, right? But Gam,
it's like when I say something strange or weird, you know, yes, it's a very polite way of saying, but God, that wasn't great.
Yeah. Gam actually do have a style, and they double, triple, like quadruple it down on it. They do get some like free checks, but I can respect that. I think their like playings was relatively good. The only thing that I would say was quite a little bit concerning for me was their basically their objective like setups moving into the context of the Swiss stage standings, where sometimes it was literally just like enemy team is there. We have not backed it properly for wards, run into river and like charge at the Drake slash like Baron and fight. But apart from that, you know, they're really, really interesting. They're always a pleasure to watch. Levi is such a fun player through and all the different evolutions.
And also say, like, Levi, last couple of years, hasn't really been looking by himself. Like, I'm pretty close to the VCS English folks. They didn't broadcast nearly as much this year because of everything that happened. But see, also, by the way, serious shout-out to the folks that did do, I think, 5 years of amateur coverage, like, obviously unpaid, of VCS. That's an unreal amount of unpaid work, and they're very, very good at what they do, so props to them.
And as we know, you know, going the extra mile for unpaid work doesn't really get you anywhere in this industry, does it, Nymera? So, you know, double applause for them as well.
But yeah, so but it used to be, I think last year and the year before, maybe not, yeah, last year and the year before, it was like, look, there's like one champion which Levi locks in and he looks like his 2020-21 self, or his really peak of his powers, and that's stuff like the Wukong. I think the Shyvana has been added to that too, where he just has a different vision of the game for those kind of champions. We can get those snap engages really, really well. And it's even simple things where, you know, it seems like quite an easy thing to think, oh, I'm going to go in and CC them. Then Jin will immediately press W. Most of the time people mess up that combination. They actually don't get the timing very well. Whenever they were going in, everyone was on the same page. Their snap engages are so, so well polished. And I think that that level of comfort allowed them to play beyond nerves or anything like that. They played as though they didn't give a damn. And they were really, really good at it.
And yes, shout out. And shout out as well to the GAM CEO. He is...
TK. But oh,
he's fun on camera, and also he's like fun. I do kind of miss like having sort of charismatic like leading figures slash owners or whatever. I mean, you know, we had Carlos.
What about someone that paints himself, and covers himself in glitter and
By the way, if you want to know a little bit more about his story and stuff, I think it was Esports News UK did an interview with him where he was just I was just sat there listening to it because it was just in the waiting area for LEC. But yeah, because he used to work in LA nightlife scene and then he moved over
you can definitely see it.
So I think it was Itusa or Cecilia who did an interview with them. So shout out to them, it was a really good interview, and I don't want to like steal all the thunder there, but go read that. And he talks about how like his journey from like going from LA nightlife to then kind of going up to Vietnam, COVID hitting and then making nightlife very difficult, going into esports and then trying to tap into this huge esports gaming audience that Vietnam has. It's got third largest server in the world, something like that. It's a huge server, huge server. And I think GAM have done such a good job of representing their region. And then, as you said, doing it in this style, which is, and they do have a style, which is like these split pick, very quick compositions where they funnel a load of resources into Levi. And by the way, this is one thing which really annoys me because people only see GAM from the VCS and they take that as the style, which blah, blah, blah is everything. GAM are not the punch you in the face level one early game team that everyone assumes that they are from VCS and stuff like the past, because they thought there's a Fongvu Buffalo and from Saigon Buffalo and stuff like that. Almost every game, Levi power farms to level 6, efficient as possible, gets a couple of resources, and then they fight. GAM are still a scrappy game, but scrappy game.
Almost Kanavi-esque.
Yeah, but they're not actually just like the level 3 blah 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 everything. They're more like a mid game skirmish powerhouse. They get their resources first and then they turn it on. They're not just like the fastest early game team, which I think is a huge misconception. They fight once they have like their first components and items. They don't do it right from the off of the game. And that's why stuff like Wukong, Shyvana, which can farm well, gets level 6 and just take over the game, works so well for them. And they've just got this great instinct to be able to follow up with, you know, long range skirmish picks. Like, I mean, Kiai has always been good at his bruises, but the Aurora gave a lot of mobility. I have no idea how Aurora made, well, okay, I know how Aurora made it through the draft versus Hawks, but that's a different story. But the fact that he got that twice, Yeah, and the fact, stuff like the Camille and stuff like that too gives them like this long range follow up. Jin as well, Ashe as well, just allows them to do that. And I think, you know, it's important to talk about Levi and Kiaya. I think the one other thing which people might not realize, this is a hell of a fucking step up from Easy Love and Elio, because they were dog in region. They were so bad. The fact that they managed to I would take Easy Love over Betty from Playin's performance. I would take that over. And I would not have said that pre-tournament, because Easy Love was really struggling. Look, great mindset. He's taken pay cuts to be with the team. He's one of the guys that's famously incorruptible from VCS. Like, this guy never fell for the match fixing stuff in the past. He's one of the guys that has taken pay cuts to be on teams and to keep teams together. Like, he's spoken a lot of length about that. So he's got a lot of like goodwill within the Vietnamese scene. The fact that he stepped up and playing this kind of level right now, his chin was really good. So yeah, huge props to them. I think Garm played a style which was really, really fun to watch, and they weren't cowed by the level of the occasion put towards them.
Can I say one thing just before I let you jump in, Peter? They should not have been given Yone as much as they were. That was an absolute nonsense.
That was a problem.
And one more, I like that they're playing Poppy. Like, that is like a really nice pickup to see for like causing like dangers in draft. On you go, Peter. Sorry.
And I mean, basically, they're quite a hard team to ban out, though.
Yeah, on the whole. I mean, I want to see what happens with mid lane. If you get like a good matchup into mid lane, maybe that's a problem. Sure.
But more specifically, Peter, how do you see them against Fly? Because obviously that's their matchup.
I mean, but this to me is the most interesting game of the entire first round. Like it's so there have been times where Wippo has pushed his limits too much in lane against.
And on stream, arguably, you might say.
On stream, arguably, but like, you know, against people that he hasn't shown enough respect to.
Sorry, carry on.
Sure. But if you do that against Kiaya, he's going to murder. So, number one, danger for FlyQuest. Number two, danger for FlyQuest. This is not a team that is incredibly consistent at snowballing. And to be honest, the best way you can beat Gam is just like punish them from level one and like don't let Levi farm, right? Like and try to punish. And Inspired is very, very good at being very efficient in his farming, and he has added more ganking styles into his game, but he is at heart somebody who wants to maximize farm, right? A little bit as well, right? And therefore I think that the two strongest parts of Gam match up well into FlyQuest. Does that mean that they're going to beat FlyQuest? Oh, I don't think they're favored, but it's a super interesting matchup. Like, I think that bot lane in theory should get murdered, but you know, it's Masu and Busio's first time on the world stage. It's not that easy, right? In a studio where they are going to be the bad guys. Oh, it's a really, really interesting one.
There are a lot of Garm fans in the audience, by the way, like a lot. And you've also got people like TK just around as well. They're gonna get some hype. They'll run the crowd, I think.
Also, never underestimate Busio's ability to be completely fucking horrible at League of Legends at any given moment. That is always on the table as a possibility, you know. Anyway, right, let's move on. And very briefly, before we cover bottom half games and give our thoughts on that. 100 Thieves, guys, what went wrong? Let's keep it, you know, fairly concise. I don't really want to get into their shitty draft. Like,
I was live viewing it with Cubby, so I got Cubby's reaction live, and it was a horror story, man. I think that the ability to decide on who's going to what lane on a quick enough timing was disastrous. Absolutely disastrous. I think it was an Inspired decision to just lane swap on them by PSG, because actually, you know, I think I probably spent between games like the whole break scanning out different things that 100 Thieves did wrong in that first game in terms of the lane swap, and you know, I picked out 6-7 things within like a 3-minute period which could have made their game a lot easier, and they failed at every different step there. So their decisions about moving around the map, decision making in general, very, very bad. And you know, PSG came in with some really solid early game plans, and they were clearly the better team. It was not close.
Yeah. Thoughts, yep. Kira? Oh, sorry, Peter, go on.
Well, I mean, so we talked a bit about Pain, where I had like criticisms about Pain. I think that Pain, although I've said a lot of bad things about, you know, like their macro and their rotations, Pain are a team that know what their strengths are. They know what they're good at, and they know what they're bad at, and they draft appropriately, and they play to the lanes that they need to play to, and they're not delusional, right? Like, like Kitan gave an interview where he basically said, yeah, Mako's not very good, but you know, that we're trying our best, right? Like, I think that's the interview he gave basically. After they won their first game against Vikings. But it feels to me like 100 Thieves don't know what they're good at, and they don't know how to win, and they don't know at an international level what matters. And you can tell this because they put their best player on Red Ecton. and so, in case you're not aware, like, they're mid laner on Red Ecton, and Vex in like really, really important games. And
the Vex shit, man. Not Vex, man.
But are you called Knight? Should you be playing Vex? No.
This guy
should Knight be playing Vex? Probably not.
I mean, like, I don't even think
trust anyone to play Vex. Wait, are there actually good Vex players out there in terms of pro scene? I actually don't. Knight's not great.
Am I crazy? Did Frescovi play like
yes,
a decent
and it also
game?
Wasn't good.
It also wasn't good. Like, Alvaro.
I just don't want to see this champion. It's not a good champion.
But that's the thing. Like, I think that 100 Thieves think that they are better than they are. Like, to me, it's not like humility, right? To me, like, again, I'm going to keep going to Pain Gaming and keep going to GAM, right? Like, these two teams understand what they're good at. They understand they're not perfect teams, right? And then they're going to play to their advantages. 100 Thieves do the same thing that, okay, since we're talking about minor region teams, Loud, okay? Loud are the team from Brazil that always come, right? They come internationally and think, we can do whatever the fuck we want, right? This is the meta, we're going to go and play the meta. We're going to go and play what all these other teams and scrims are playing against us, right? And they can't do it because that's not what they're good at. Like, this is the thing that is frustrating to me. 100 Thieves, to me, this is what I think happened in 100 Thieves. They won the series against Cloud9, and they thought, fucking hell, we're a really good team. Right, we can do what we can actually play well. Where they don't think about what did they do in the series against 100 Thieves against Cloud9 to make them beat Cloud9. Like, why were they suddenly better all of a sudden than they were in the regular season and they were in the previous season? They didn't learn the lesson, and like they come into this World Championships, they think, okay, we're going to go and stomp all of these emerging region teams, and then they don't because they're not playing to their strengths. And to me, this is the thing that pisses me off about 100 Thieves, because I think Sniper is really good. I think that they have potential in their team. I don't think they're shit, but they just don't understand what makes them good. And so to me, it's a good, you know, as far as I'm concerned, good riddance, right? Like, I mean, to me, this is what they're doing is showing disrespect to the emerging region teams, and they got punished, and you know, fuck off, right? Like, and that's how I feel. That's how I feel. I'm not sympathetic towards them. You know, they have rookies on the team that I like, but you know, learn this lesson and you know, don't disrespect the teams that come into North America from LLA next year. Right?
Also, it's not like it was even close, right? Like, they never looked good at any point during play-ins. They got absolutely rolled in some of these games. Like, they
also Ayla had that could be a career-defining performance. Actually, Ayla played really, really badly. I think Woody was the biggest difference in terms of individual player on that map. And like, you know, I'm always sympathetic towards rookies. Mistakes can be hard, losses can be hard, and sometimes they need to be hard to learn something. But oh my god, you know, that flash in laning phase against the Alistar in game 2, where he flashes backwards basically into the enemy and duo lane to die. That is the kind of panicked shock decision where you will see that replay in your head for years to come. And I really hope he can get over it, but that was very, very poor on an individual level in terms of a series from him.
And it wasn't even like they were all playing, but like River was bad. There was very limited things he could do today, right? But like River has been pretty good this tournament in the first two series, though. He almost like
also,
dragged
also very painful for River, given that he used to be the PSG guy. So even more stinging for him.
Yeah. Kira, any additional thoughts on the 100 train wreck?
Yeah. So basically, if you pick basically 7 unique ADCs and 7 unique junglers in play-ins going into worlds, your coaching staff are morons, or your prep is moronic. I don't give a fuck, mate. I don't care. Like that is impossible. Like how is that? That's not real. That can't be. League of Legends should never look like that. You're not those guys. Like, how? Right, to be fair, the only way that could happen is if River, who's a very competent player, feels so strongly, right, about a specific jungle matchup, you know what I mean? That he thinks he could, like, carry the game. So, like, you know what I mean? Like, The vehicle game that he almost like gets over the line. It's a little bit unfortunate. You know, I can
did
see
you,
that.
Did you and... see the Hoopoo community comments on that, where they rated Rivers Viega 9.8 out of 10 and said, yeah. if you were allowed to kill your own teammates, you should have killed your mid laner to be engaged as Vex yes. and then kill your AD carry to clean up the rest of the team fight. Holy, rolled and smoked.
Yeah, like, no, but like, in-game, that's what I'm in-game. Saying. Like, yeah, of course, but like that. This is a like, and this is like what worries me. The other one I would say is that Sniper's got like that Oscar problem, where insanely talented player has a really good eye for like team fights, like pretty good mechanics, can't lane, like literally can't lane, can't conceive of lane tactics, can't conceive of lane prep. Will just death push, death spiral every lane. Seems to have like no cerebralism when he's handed like problem solving situations like on the fly. That's not this. I'm not calling him an idiot. What I'm saying is like when he's handed things that are not he's not familiar with, there seems to be like a degree of like panic or inability. By the way, and you know this happens to a lot of players. And you know, so Sniper is a rare, very competent like any talent, particularly in like top lane. I think the guy's like supremely competent. Many people would like not die, but like would wish they had the mechanical capabilities that he has. But like at the end of the day, the decision making doesn't allow him to show that. You know what I mean? And sometimes he can put his team into situations that aren't worth it. I think the bot lane was super super poor. I think the whole ADC like draft like a prep and like conception was super super poor. Like a was it Tomo? Was it Tomo that got clipped by the Tomo, Lucian Namo and he doesn't even flash on Jinx and just like
Tomo
dies?
Tomo also got solo killed by Azure as Gnar in a lane, in a 1v1 on the other side of the map. So he actually got killed twice, but no, once or twice. Look, it was bad. Tomo had a very bad series. I think he had a bad year, like bad worlds as well. It's not a
and I'm, like, but I'm not even just trying to throw like all the players under the bus, because when the prep is this like poor that like and you're left just to your like own devices against like teams whose prep is like better than yours, it's really hard, because sometimes Planes and Worlds is that little bit step further. I actually do think 100 Thieves kind of rode like a run of form in playoffs to like be here, but, you know, more kudos to them. I think the R7 series was them at their like worst, and that was an example of like that's basically the different, you know, there's different types of choking. That's choke of expectations, where you're losing against a team that you in your head you should theoretically be beaten, and the desperation of you thinking you should beat them causes you to hit a spiral of consistently playing worse and worse and worse and worse. The RNG team of Season 8, that's happened to them like all the time, by the way. This actually happened to them at Worlds versus Vitality, yeah. where they had a Kaiser Rives like comp and they were fighting at like 15 minutes and they just death spiraled the full game. Like, this isn't something unique to just like playing teams, but I think you can see it on display here.
I think we also saw it in Mad Lions too, though. But like, I mean, I think that
come
to this international tournament, you think, oh well, we're going to stomp all of these teams. And to me, this is just like disrespectful, right? Like it's they didn't judge the teams for who they were. Like I've been on teams like this who go to international. Like, trust me, when you're on a team with Inspired and Impact, like, you know, sometimes getting them to sit down and like respect these emerging region teams so that you don't, there's no danger you're going to get surprised by them. Like, that's what they should have been doing. They shouldn't be watching the main region teams. Focus on your emerging region teams. Know what R7 are going to do to you, right? Like, it's not like they should have been losing to Rainbow Seven, right? Like, they should be comfortably beating them, right? PSG is hard, but they're only playing PSG because they messed up earlier, right?
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
You know, the one thing though that I think is their Mad's like first games, which is against Vikings, which is obviously the weakest opponent that they played, that at least they had very respectful drafting. I think even some of 100 Thieves drafting was like ? But you know what this actually reminds me of? It reminds, because I'm with you guys where like I'm kind of like good riddance, because I think, you know, they were a very weak team coming into Worlds anyway. They have no right to believe that they are better than like a peripheral might make it through, might make it not through play-ins kind of team. It didn't really feel like that was their attitude going in. You know what it really reminds me of? If any of you have seen that clip from that CSGO, that female CSGO LAN, where after the team loses, so they had like a very impressive qualifying campaign to get there, and then one of the analyst guys is like, I'm just really disappointed in them. Like, I really wish they could have just shown me something, like anything. And then the female analyst is like, starts popping off at him. He's like, how dare you? These girls work so hard to be here. Blah, blah, blah. And she has like a breakdown, basically. It's a really funny clip. But the thing is, it's like, who cares? I don't care if they beat Cloud9 in NA. I don't care. Like, if you're going to perform like that and be that shit and disrespectful and you're drafting your gameplay against these minor region teams, no, you don't deserve to get praised and be like, well, at least they made it to the dance. Dude, you were dancing like a fucking great grandpa at a funeral, mate. Like, that's horrendous. You don't just get an award for... Your reward was the ticket to go to Worlds, right? You don't deserve another pat on the back.
That's conceptually, by the way, this is, and Riot's like previous like conception of how like Worlds works, okay, this is actually like the same as like an LPL or an LCK team like not making it through like play-ins, and then like this used to be like rated the same, by the way, like that's like there used to be like an LCK and an LPL team in play-ins like doing this, yeah. right now, and like expectations, and you know what I mean, and you can argue whether that should or should not happen, the conception. But there are four major regions. They're called that, and there are a bunch of minor regions, and they're called that for a reason. You have all the advantages. You're supposed to be like the premier server, and so your excuses are actually more like foible, because the minor region teams are supposed to be the ones like without the support. So not. More like kudos. That's why I actually enjoy play-ins. I love watching them like fuck shit up. Like I love watching GAM just torch like teams like unexpectedly. Yeah, I think
that's the last thing I should bring up on this. And I'm sure Peter, when he gets back,
you don't need to undermine.
Which is when I started my casting career, obviously I started out with LGL, so I have some emotional connection to them. And obviously nowadays I'm very well known for comparative for LPL and LEC, and people kind of forget about that stuff. I also started casting UK tier 3 and 4, like amateur stuff, real grassroots, and UK university stuff too. And like, yeah, the left, no. And that's in terms of gameplay, appropriate reaction. I will say some of the most exciting games which I've ever cast. Well, this is the thing, right? That there are multiple things you can value when watching esports, and I think one of them is gameplay. There is never a bad thing to value good gameplay. That is a good thing to value. One of the biggest things I learned from... So there's an amateur tournament in Europe called Valence League, which only does below diamond competitive stuff, because Riot gets a little bit iffy about high elo competitive tournaments, but this thing's around for years. Some of the very best games that I cast in my first few years of casting were like people in bronze and silver missing Malphite Orianna combos in game 5 of a finals.
But it
means so much to them and to their fans, and also in that case too, they know that like they don't get many chances like be on stream and do something like that. There's an important thing there too. It's not that kind of love. That's hyperbole. Hey,
Nymera, we've all played Clash, buddy. I know what the stakes are. Okay.
There is something. So like the Rainbow Seven Pain game, and I saw your tweet about this earlier as well, Peter. I completely fucking agree. That is probably the most important match you will ever watch for like those regions and those players and anything like that. Symbolically, oh my god, that is huge. And I think I'm very happy that I've had similar experiences for some people at lower levels where the gameplay is not necessarily the focus, but the meaning of it instead. Because that's why I've always loved play-ins. Because you're going to have whole hosts of fan bases which don't really get to cheer for anyone specifically in the main stage in the way that other people do, in such an important way. And you know, the excitement which I felt for the DFM Exodia roster that made it through to Worlds Groups in 21, I'm so happy that the CBLOL fans get to have that now with Pain making it through for their last ever CBLOL appearance at Worlds and stuff like that. So, like, to wrap off play-ins, I'm really glad we got to get this banger CBLOL versus LLA for thing to work that out, because look, it's not always going to be about gameplay, but oh my god, I would take this like absolute soap opera drama game 3 stuff. Absolutely peak entertainment. Good.
That was good.
I feel genuinely lucky. Like, I mean, I've been involved in esports since basically season 1, like League of Legends esports, and this is like in my top 5 most important, you know, like maybe top 10 most important. Top 10. Like, there's been a lot of
genuinely one of the most entertaining things I've ever watched.
It meant so much to so many people, and there is no rematch. There is no revenge. You know, there is no coming back from this. You know,
that's it.
Sign off. And we are going to So I mean, I feel very lucky to have watched this game today. The quality of the game was pretty shocking, I'm going to be honest.
I actually felt like that added something to the occasion, because I couldn't accurately predict anything which happened in that game, which meant I had to just witness it. I just had to witness it. I couldn't guess what was happening.
But it showed as well the stress that these guys were under, you know?
Yeah.
This was great. And basically, Pain get the chance now to make somebody bleed. and there's somebody who's going to, like, either they're going to lose to Pain or they're going to, like, get murdered in the first 15 minutes or something like this, and they're going to get they're going to get their moment. And trust me, as somebody, you know, I was on INTZ in 2016, the INTZ, the BTDG, like, that feeling,
was the last time that CBLOL was in groups, by the way, or groups equivalent. So that was the last time that CBLOL made it that far. Yep. They've never been to groups. They've never qualified through play-ins. They only got through International Wildcard Invitational. Oh. So they got through in 2016, and they've never been in groups since then. This is the only time they've been to a groups equivalent. So the last time was you.
Yep. There's your gravestone, Peter. Congratulations.
Holy shit.
Peter, you're supposed to be watching this region, by the way. you're supposed to be on top of this stuff.
It doesn't feel like it. The thing is, it doesn't feel like it because there have been so many good players that can come up through Brazil, right? Like, it's just, yeah, I mean, like, I guess you're right. Like, I mean, I'm not thinking all the time, you know, but you know, if they go, they, like, and I don't know who they, right? Like, maybe they go 0-5, right? But they're going to get the chance. I think this is a team that, yeah, that, you know, if you disrespect them, they can beat you. And, you know, I'm glad that we got the final series today. I've enjoyed this a lot. I think people helped make it spicy. I think 100 Thieves helped make it spicy. But did you see the tweet with...
Yes. The whole doing it for APA with Summit.
Summit one, which apparently, like, triggered Summit so hard that, like, he was, like, mega locked in for their series. So maybe not the smartest thing to do, you know, like, antagonize the ball before you're about to fight it. I had an emergency before, so I didn't get to do the final thing on 100 Thieves. But the funniest thing that I saw for 100 Thieves is did you see the Vulcan tweet when they lost?
Nope.
When 100 Thieves lost?
I didn't.
What does this do for Cloud Nine's 2024 legacy? Did you know?
Watching Plans, this made me an advocacy. I actually think, I'm not joking, that, first of all, I've said that a million times, I won't go over it again. Play-in should be bigger, right? Just in general, yeah. I think play-ins is an amazing thing. I think it should be bigger. It should be its own, like, tournament. Okay. Second of all, I genuinely think they should, like, mirror regions for, like, qualifiers so that they're, like, on purpose, by the way. And they should have been doing this for years. Like, having, you know, like, Brazil playing like that and, like, a playoff. Have the Battle of the Atlantic, yeah, you know, the fourth seed of, like, NA versus, like, Korea, like, China. Not because, you know what I mean? Like Riot gave up trying to make, like, the most, like, concrete format years ago. But, like, in terms of just perspective optics, it would have been, like, WWE MMA-esque, like, levels of, like, interest. And just watching this play-ins made me want that more and more and more.
But this is the thing. So there are very few people. So obviously Nymeria, who's not here anymore, but there's very few people who, like, really, really enjoyed this international wildcard stuff, you know, like, and this is why, you know, it's like, so you saw Brazil versus Latin America, but the real big one was not Brazil, Latin America. It was Brazil, Turkey. And
Brazil, Turkey
fucking hated each other. Like, I've heard stories. This was before I was on INTZ. It was the split before. But I would hear stories from those INTZ guys, from, like, Falcons and Volta, telling me about how they went to Turkey and they played in a stadium in Turkey. Like, it was like a football stadium or something. And they said that they thought that if they won that game, they wouldn't leave alive. Because that's what the fans were like. They were hostile. They were like, it was brutal. And when the Turkish teams came to Brazil, just as hard. Close to as hard, right? Like, and that's what we've lost. And, like, the, you know, now we have the sanitized version of America. Naomi, we were just talking about the international wildcard, you know, about what we've lost from the international wildcard. So, you know, we don't have Brazil Turkey anymore. We don't have, like, Vietnam versus, like,
LCL, you know, got nuked. LCL got Albus. They had the region of Albus, Nox, Luna. That's gone.
Yeah. And I mean, this now is what we've lost, and it makes me sad. And frankly, you know, it is what it is. You know, this is a new era we're moving,
like,
into.
I think for the way it's been handled, this is the right decision because it streamlines it. Because realistically, Riot didn't want to put in the scaffolding which could have made Tier 2 much, much more fun and engaging. I think that there was a huge amount of potential in Tier 2, and, you know, we both enjoy it, and I think a lot of other people do too, because it gives people a team to cheer for, which you know, which encompasses a whole load of the world. Minor regions, if you look at the actual population of, like, server population and then population of just the planet in general, minor regions cover an awful lot of the planet, which is a huge amount of untapped fan bases. You are potentially losing a bit of that. However, with current resources and streamlining, it's probably I understand why they're doing this.
I mean, to be clear, I feel the loss personally, but like there's a lot of people, you know, the fact that Brazil still exists as a region, there are a ton of Brazilian fans who enjoy like their final victory over Turkey, you know, because Turkey doesn't exist. And to me, I'm literally sad by outlasting them.
How Napoleonic of you, you know?
Oh, I mean, it's tragic, but yeah.
Anyway, we do need to move on to teams that actually have a chance of winning the tournament. I'm sorry, you know, it is what it is. So yeah, let's talk about a rematch of the Esports World Cup finale, which is obviously Top Esports versus T1. An absolute banger in the second half of this Swiss draw. So Nymera, give me your initial thoughts on this matchup. And, you know, maybe as well the meta, because obviously we haven't seen T1 since the latest patch, right?
I think, so... viewing this from a Top Esports follower, someone who's followed them across the entire year, probably one of the better draws they could get right now, because just because of the name brand of T1, they will be viewed in some ways as underdogs. Even though T1 came limping into this tournament, I think just in terms of name brand value, it's enough to kind of switch Top Esports' brains on, which they do need a bit. I think that my worry for Top Esports is that they could overlook some teams. I don't think you can do that with them, so I think that's important. And it's also not an elimination match. So it is it's the lowest pressure, highest seeming level opponent that you can get at this point in the tournament. And that hopefully gives them a chance to take a win here. Maybe it's a best of one, we'll see. And hopefully get some momentum. That's really, really important. And then you just hope they can ride that momentum to a point in the tournament. Because I'm really worried about their mental state, because Top Esports has had a year of multiple different people on the team. Just really not doing well in particular elimination matches when they have actually when they've been viewed as favorites. I think they've actually done worse in some situations. So that's kind of in terms of the mentality thing. I think that's kind of an important thing. I think that there's been a lot of buffs which I think will favor T1. I think having Faker on mage duty is so much better for the team, because ideally what T1 wants, and I think this is setting up well in terms of a meta for them, is Faker masters the mage matchups in mid lane, whether just both sides of whatever matchup he wants, whether that's Orianna, Syndra, or there's an Ahri involved, or whether he picks up something like the Huey again or something like that. He's proficient at that, and just get something to allow him to be a safe blind pick pushing mid laner. If he can do that, I think T1 is set for a really good meta for them. We'll see whether their team fighting instincts and the macro catches up with that too, but it's setting up for the formula they used to do a hell of a lot of work with last year, obviously, when they won the tournament. So that's a worry. I think on the other side, Tien, very versatile. I think top lane meta is still perfect for 369 in terms of what he wants to do, just team fighting top lane as that peel for his team. Hopefully he looks for a strong enough team fighting laning phase. Cream was never a mage player, but then he became one on this team, and then he was okay at stuff like... His Victor was okay, I guess, but he's become a mage recently, so I'd expect him to be picking stuff up the way up again. And then the question is, you know, what happens to stuff like bot lane? Both these AD carries fantastic on Varus. Varus is back. I think Varus is incredibly strong right now. So hopefully what we're going to see is two teams with a lot of comfort picks to choose between. I don't think either team feels on the out with the meta. I think Ona going back towards more brawly bruiser stuff in the jungle is much better for him. So I think for Top Esports, it's good for them to kind of either take a hard L early, but without elimination game, but also just have their brain switched on from the off. I think that's a really good thing for them. But on the whole, as much as T1 come in as fourth seed from LCK, the meta changes are huge for what we know they can succeed with.
I do think you made one critical error in your analysis, Nymera, though I agree with a lot of it, which is there is a lot at stake here, because I will remind you that three of their players were in my top 10. So, you know, they're playing for that apart from anything else. You know, they've been given
still can't believe that, but anyway.
Well, hey, you know, you had two of them, so there it is.
No, I didn't.
Yeah, you did. Wait, didn't
no,
you?
I didn't.
You had Jackie Love. And you had Tien, right? Okay. Well, whatever. Anyway.
You shout hands on that one.
Yeah. Let's see how Mako does, I guess, to see how controversial a pick that was.
Without your eyes closed.
I would say that Maokai, not the champion, the coach
Coach,
really, really likes
Wait.
To put Cream
Sorry, time out. What? Is there actually a coach called Maokai?
Yeah.
Yes, he won Worlds with EDG in 21.
Yeah.
Do you not know who this is?
How's his, Maokai, how's his name spelled? Crazy,
no? Maokai, like the champion.
Maokai, the champion.
That shouldn't be allowed. Anyway, sorry, carry
he's
on.
Not on the, he's not on the bloody team. You don't have to show it in Summoner's Rift, but they have.
Anyway, like, he really likes to keep putting cream on Azir for some reason, and I have not been impressed on cream's Azir.
They haven't done that for most of summer now. That's true.
But I do think that his Huey is actually really, really good. And I think if you'd asked me this a year ago before like Huey was like properly, I don't even remember when Huey was released. Huey was released during Worlds last year, no?
Huey was started this year. So he wasn't available last year. So it's basically just this spring.
Yeah, exactly.
I think Cream is 7-0 or 7-1 on the champion. He's undefeated on it this year.
But basically like, I think that if you'd asked me in this meta a year ago how bad mid is going to be, I think I think it would have been a lot worse last year. But I think Huey gives some play to him in the mage versus mage matchup. I don't think his is that good. I think his Orianna is pretty shocking. If you ask me what do I want Cream on, I want him on Akali, I want him on Ahri, I want him on Sylas.
Tristana, he can still play Tristana and
but the fact that he has Huey in a mage meta, if it comes down to mage versus mage and he has to play a mage, he's got one now which he didn't have before, which I think is a big deal. And everything else, I agree with everything else you said about T1. This is like the best time for them to play T1. It's good for them to gain momentum.
Oh, his Jace might be worth picking as well, although Jace is good in mage meta, so there's a chance of that.
Yeah, fair. Fair.
Jace has been hanging around a couple of scrims from what I've seen.
I agree, except that I'm a bit lower down on his mage flag. But I think this is definitely one of the most interesting games.
Quick question coming into tier one play. Do you think you should leave Jinx open at all this tournament?
Depends how good your level one plans are. Because if you can ensure standard lanes with good level ones, if you have something like a Braum kill lane or something like that, stuff that can walk into the enemy jungle early, I think that you can leave it open as long as you're confident that you can secure 2v2 lane. But you can't let that open, understanding the fact that there can be lane swaps. If you have a poor level one comp and you leave the Jinx open, I think you're putting yourself at risk.
And do you think that risk is worth not just banning it and banning something else?
Depends on team versus team. If there's other stuff jungle mid top picks which are too problematic, that can be a problem.
I don't think you can give T1 Jinx at this tournament, like, period. I don't think you let Guma play Jinx at any point in this tournament at all. I think you could ban almost anything else on T1. I don't think you ever let Guma play Jinx.
I mean, if you can get something like Nocturne Orianna and they don't have something like a Tahm Kench, I think you're okay with it. I think there are some combinations which work with it. Camille Gallio could potentially work too. I think there are some Camille comps which work.
Yeah, but I've seen so few teams actually do those. Like,
but put it this way, I think that if it was a team like... Yeah, no, I think with top esports, they are good enough at their front-to-back team fighting that I think that they can find combos with it. Like, they could, if they can find a good enough angle to have, like, an Ornn comp into a Ksante or something like that, that could work too. Like, but don't let it through without having a significant answer. You can't sleepwalk into a Jinx pick in this tournament, though.
Because the weird thing is Guma and Jakulov both have... Because I watched... Like, I really slithered on having Guma instead of Jakulov on my, like, list. Some of the stuff that fell away probably in like Guma's like favor was more the deterioration of his team rather than his like own play, and he was less able to like show me like as much facets as like Jakulov. Though I think in hindsight, he probably maybe could have made it there because I've been rewatching loads of VODs. Both these ADCs have like massive champion pools, like in terms of like buffs, but probably the two like most potent picks on the patch, like Ziggs and Jinx, they're both very good at them. Like Jakulov's is maybe the second best or third best Ziggs player in the LPL. He's not played
a
lot of it.
Carl is best, maybe Light second best. Yeah,
that's what I'm saying. So he's like one of the better like things. But I don't even know if TES have like shown a propensity to use it this year. No, I don't think that. They've got one game on it. Sorry, yeah, they had one game on it the entire year. I'm really interested in what TES's identity is going to be. I'm really interested to see what 369's champion pool is going to look like. I'm really interested in what Tian's going to play at this tournament. I really want to see what Mako is going to be playing in this tournament, if they're going to prioritise heavily for 2v2 in bot lane. Because you can't do that as much if they go for Ziggs and Jinx. and what they think is going to be the best ADC. So I think it's this is going to show a lot of flavour into what these two teams like think. Because you've got to remember, last time they played was the EWC Finals, and I actually think Top Esports going in were favoured outside the fact that like Tian can't play in Finals. And it shows once again that he can't play in Finals. But to me, like, it's very, very, it'll be very, very, very strange to see like what these teams come up with. I think the meta does favor, the meta changes massively favor Faker. The changes like that cannot be denied. And when Faker's on Comfort, it just makes T1 a much more potent and dangerous team. What do you think about Korea with the support changes? Do you think he's going to find his way out of the mire and the pit of despair that he ended up in, where he just couldn't find any efficacy on the map?
I mean, I think a lot of the same supports from Summer are still around, so I think it's not guaranteed that he'll find his way out of that. I think if you're playing stuff like, I mean, we saw the one game of Kalista Nico in play-ins. I think they will need to find a way to get Carry on to champions he's more comfortable on, because his play-in Summer was one of the most hit, considering I think Carry was on track to become pantheon of supports all time. I think he's already in there or on the cusp of it. If he had like another storming year, he would have had three back-to-back years of arguably being best support in the world. But this year has been historic in terms of its drop-off from level of form. So he needs to find something to get more comfortable onto that isn't just, you know, ramming his face into poor engages time after time. He's not a good tank player. He plays tanks as a big engage, flashy engages, not actually his tanks themselves. His frontline duty is actually much, it's lacking compared to other people in the world. We talked about that a lot in our LCK podcast. So I want to see what he can do in terms of more explosive potential kind of picks, see if he can get some kind of mage support so, back.
By the way,
or something
are
like that.
Any of you actually favouring T1 here? Like, if I was to say to make a prediction,
I think it's close.
You...
I actually think it's close.
I actually with the meta change and not knowing what either team looks like going in, I actually favor T1 under one condition, and I'm about to come to this next one here, Rich. The changes to like Senna, like Jakula, I don't think Jakula have played the new Senna like at all, and the new way that Senna looks favors T1 more than it favors, in my opinion, ES.
I mean, Senna itself can unlock Carrier, right? Like, even if he's not the one playing it, I think that can. I think.
Yeah, T1 but I let Senna play around... almost anything.
Yeah,
no,
well,
that's the thing.
When T1 play around Senna as a champion in the bot lane, I think Carrier is even more unlocked. Again, regardless of who's playing it. But yeah, I mean, Peter, what's instinctively, how do you feel about this matchup? Do you think that one team's favoured over the other?
I mean, like, it's got to be Top Esports now. Like, I mean, I think that every single time T1... I mean, I think it's worth saying that T1 have a lot over their heads right now, right? Like, they're under a lot more pressure. they're coming off a bad split. I mean, I think the meta will favor them. I think that basically Faker will be able to micromanage Carrier, so we won't need to worry too much about Carrier's individual champion pool, provided Faker's fine. But I don't think we can see T1 as being favored. Doesn't mean I don't think that they can win. You know, I don't think it's like, we're not talking about wild card versus, you know, an LPL team here, right? But like, I don't see how they win this series unless like, Zeus goes completely.
Well, this
crazy.
Is my problem. I think that if the picks fall into like pushing mid that allows Ona to maintain lanes like they did last Worlds, Zeus could get Yone top lane into a good matchup. He could get Jace into a good matchup or something
it's
like that.
Into 369.
Yeah, but 369 individual lane this year has been poor. It's been his worst individual laning year for a while.
Yeah, that's what I'm worried about. Like, I don't know how he lanes.
That's a worry. And then I think Kreme and mage versus mage. Look, he's a fine mage player, but I don't think he's going to be beating Faker. If Faker comes into mages and he plays like we know he can on mages, that could be a problem. And like, as we said, bot lane changes could potentially upset bot that as well. So I genuinely think there is a route to rear victory for T1, but I also think that this is the best time for Top Esports to face them, because one, they won't have to face them again through Swiss. It's not an elimination match. They are against a high team name brand team, so hopefully that turns their brains on as well a little bit. I hope that mental difficulty doesn't kind of come into it, because they have had some real collapses mentally. So I think this is the best Top Esports should look against them. With a number of factors, unless prep is really, really off in that case, that's kind of a mute point. But yeah, I can genuinely see Top Esports losing to T1 in the current meta based on what we're assuming.
Sure.
But right. I still, what, 60-40s?
It's going to be like close to a pick'em anyway. I'd be interested to see what the actual odds were. I assume Top Esports is probably slightly favoured, but I doubt it's by too much. Right, let's talk about Fnatic versus DK. I think this is a really interesting one because both these teams, I think it's fair to say, although, you know, it's different levels, sure, but they're both very volatile teams. They can look great with particular compositions one game and then the next game look fucking awful. I think it, from that standpoint, this, I mean, Peter made a good point about, you know, FlyQuest GAM being like one of the most interesting BO1s. I think this is one of the most interesting BO1s because I think there's so many variables on how this can look in the context of a singular game. Peter, what are your first thoughts on Fnatic versus DK? In fact, let's look at it through the prism of European fans. How does Fnatic beat DK here?
And they snowball and hope that mid-game has gotten better. I mean, Fnatic have always been a pretty decent, like, first 15-minute team, right?
There was a period this year when their TVTs were going really badly, but most of the summer they've been here.
I think you should caricature that as Razlok's really good in the first few.
Sure, of course. But like,
distinction's quite clear.
Their 2v2s were good in summer.
Yeah, but I mean, I know that it's popular to shit on Fnatic, right? Like, for losing to G2 all of those times, you know, with what were the ridiculous goal leads that they had at like 15 minutes in every single one of those games. But, you know, like, this, for me, this is a step up for Fnatic. Because Fnatic do have those leads into G2, right? Like, they didn't have those leads in the past into G2.
I agree.
And they have the leads to throw, right? They have the leads to throw. And to me, I think that Fnatic are one of those teams that have the opportunity to upset a lot, right? Like, they have the ability to get those leads, and there will be games where you cannot throw every single game, right? Like, it's impossible.
No, they did. No, Peter, you don't understand. You're laughing. They did. They did throw every game. They They played nine games, and they threw all of them. Like, they had leads in nine games. Sorry, they threw all of them except one. So you're right. They can't throw every single game, but they can throw every single series because they can only win one game.
Nine times out of ten, the proof's in the pudding, Kira. It was only nine times out of ten.
I corrected myself. No, actually, I forgot they won that one game in finals. Peter, you're right. They can't throw every game. Continue with what you were going to say. You're correct.
I mean, to be honest, like, Fnatic fans seem really, really fucking mad. I don't know why they're so mad. Like, you know, like they
this team's not supposed to win. It's like so over expectations of where it's supposed to be.
Considering where Fnatic were last year, considering where they've been for, like, you know, years compared to G2, right? Compared to G2, not compared to the rest of the league. You know, like, there's reason to be optimistic, and I think that there are things that Fnatic can do, right? It's Razzle focused. Obviously he's going to need to show something good. Lucid has been really, really up and down. I think this guy has the potential to be like one of, like, really, really, really good. How old is he? He's young though. He's a rookie this year.
He's been a rookie for a year academy. Or two. Yeah.
Yeah, but he was there with Paul Bai and like all the rest in the academy. But yeah, like, I'm just checking on, okay, so he's 19. He's older than I thought he was. But like, but yeah, I mean, he has shown a lot of bright spots this year. I'm looking forward to seeing how he does in this tournament. This is a really generic comment because when you're talking about Fnatic, you know how it's going to go. If they're behind, they can't win. If they're ahead, they are going to struggle to win, but like, at least they have a chance, right? And like, that's a reality.
By the way, I was going to say that Lucid is 5 years younger than Super, just to put that in context.
Yeah, he's 19, 2000. God, born in 2005.
Rookie of the split, Super.
Can't remember, but yeah, he's been an academy since.
I'm joking. That's like the kind of, he's like 35 years old, five kids, a mortgage. Rookie of the split.
Was he rookie of the split?
I don't know.
I don't remember.
Oscar was that much, but yeah.
Sure.
So Kira, what do you think? Can Fnatic, I'll just say, by the way, but I give Fnatic a decent shot in this game.
Right, okay. Do I hear something since starting that? Everyone talks, okay, about Fnatic and their ability to upset or like win games, okay? Here's what happened. If you go through their entire track record, I've been doing research, you know what I mean? Okay. They beat T1 once. They had a really close game against EDG twice, but lost them. They upset Top Esports once, then lost the other two games. One of them was really close, okay? Now, here's the thing. Close just doesn't matter in League of Legends. It's still an L, okay? The Western teams, I can tell you, were close in games. Fucking get in line, mate, by the way. Fucking hell. Right, okay, so their entire record is they beat T1 in one game, and they beat TES and the play-ins of MSI in 2024. Their record of actually winning games against Eastern teams is shocking. They are currently this, like, iteration of Razorc, Humanoid, Oscar in him, and a little bit of the Wonder. I counted some of that. They are 2-14 versus Eastern teams in total matches, and their two wins are against Top Esports and T1s and a BO3 and a BO1. That is the totality of their contribution currently to League of Legends, and a bunch of close games.
I'm also pretty sure as well that when was the last time that Humanoid faced Showmaker? Was it actually MSI?
Yeah, that was 21? The one you're thinking of.
Whenever it was? Yeah. No, MSI 21?
No, it was Worlds 20.
The Syndra Ori game.
Yeah, the Syndra Ori game, the last time they played.
Yeah, but basically, I seem to remember every time they faced up, Showmaker has just dog-walked Humanoid. Like,
no, Humanoid was good at MSI, and then at Worlds, like, Showmaker showed them what levels.
Yeah. I seem to remember even at MSI, like, Showmaker was still, like, godlike at that point, too, though.
It was so godlike, but Humanoid got, like, 3 solo kills on him, Zoe matchup, and then he also played the Syndra reverse matchup.
I actually think Zoe could make a comeback at some point this Worlds, by the way. Apparently,
LS was talking about it on support, Louis Conan.
But apparently, Zoe with Lichbane is apparently really good right now. So there's like some outside world where that happens. Anyway, that's a separate thing. But yeah, I think mid lane could be an issue. We'll see what kind of form Humanoid's on. Because Humanoid is, again, he's just one of those other players that can just randomly show up and give his best self, or can,
this meta suits Humanoid a lot, by the way.
Suits Showmaker a lot, too, because he's one of the best mage players of all time. And if he gets to play a load of burst AP champion, Showmaker is going to be very, very happy. So, yeah, I don't think the meta changes affect either player that much, because both are getting a boost from that, I think. I think bot lane is going to be very interesting, because I'm pretty sure that Moam, by the way, was listed as sub, not as starting member. I think that Kellen was listed as starting. I seem to remember that Kellen was listed as at least I saw some stuff there. I don't know whether that can change in the hours leading up to the first game. I don't know when their roster decision is or something like that.
24 hours before is usually.
But that can be quite big, because I think that Moam was awesome on Rel. His laning on other stuff wasn't awesome though. So His laning phase was a little bit more suspect, whereas Kellen was a bit more lane focused, but then struggled to land those engages outside of lane with stuff like the Nautilus. He had some like historic ints actually with that one. But yeah, if they play more heavily towards 2v2, great benchmark to see how Noah and Jun can do against international competition in a 2v2 standard. Because earlier in the year, around MSI and then EWC, they had some shocking 2v2s, and then in summer they went to doing some really, really good 2v2s. So if they can keep that rolling, that could be very, very big for them if they can continue that onwards. I am quite worried about top lane. I think that Oscar had a really good showing against 369. I think that Kingen is not someone you can get a leg over that easily in just individual laning, though. I think his individual laning has been really good this year, which is not something which I've often said against him. I think a lot of people remember Kingen in 22, where it was like, well, you know, did really well in that Worlds Finals, but besides that, was not necessarily awesome as an individual player. I think if he finds an option to bust out a gangplank and just like hold Oscar in and down for a while and until he kind of scales up. Also, King is a very good Jax player. Not that Oscar in and isn't as well. That could be a bit of an issue. I think, you know, Fnatic are a very volatile team. They're also another team, like I was talking about with BLG earlier, where they're quite good at reacting to game states. Listening to them in Champions Queue is very fun, by the way, because you can just hear them just like, right, dropping that plan, doing something else. Razor is like, okay, cool, let's do this. It's really funny where they're just like, right, let's just abandon that plan to do something. That could be so, so funny. I think any of these three teams facing up is just going to make me smile all the way game through. Fnatic, Damwon, and Weibo, whatever happens with these three teams, I'm just like, anything can happen. I'm just happy to witness this happening. Realistically, I think the stock value, the actual just individual level of players, probably much higher on Damwon. But there's a chance that Fnatic just somehow hands diff their way through a couple of skirmishes and make their way through the start of the game as well.
This will be a great litmus test for Razor versus like Lucid, because I know
Jun needs to get some more comfort champions, because I really didn't like his Leona. No Leona Jun. Yeah, Jun's not good.
Jun's actually been terrible in the summer second half,
which is a shame, because if he gets on his choice champions, this guy is absolutely insane, as we know from MSI.
Yeah.
what would you call it? Like, everyone, like, you know, all the Koreaboo, like, LCK worshippers, like, were losing their mind that a Westerner, never mind anything else, a Spanish Westerner, could be better than, possibly better than a Korean at jungle. That conception, they just could not, they could not handle that idea. And so it'll be a good, like, litmus test of, like, seeing how that, like, matches up. Because, funnily enough, Razork, even though he's been somewhat of the linchpin of a lot of Fnatic success and why they get anywhere, and arguably one of the best players in the LEC this year, I've been watching a lot of Fnatic games, doing some research, not good internationals. MSI was not kind to Razork, Worlds wasn't kind to Razork. By the way, he's got a lot, not to answer for, that's a terrible way to put it, but he's got a lot to show. He's got a lot to, you can't, it's that whole like Doublelift thing of like, Doublelift came in to like Worlds, the best ADC from NA, six times from NA, and basically two of them just bombed out. Two of them he was mid, and two of them he was good. Razork, you know, how many times, you're not going to get like an infinite amount of fucking chances at being good. You eventually, at one of them, you do actually have to do it. That doesn't mean he has to qualify. He has to actually be like, you know, he has to show the propensity to do it. It's that next step. What is it, Peter?
But I mean, like, teams are 90%. Like, if I am a team playing into Fnatic at Worlds and I'm an Asian team, 90% of my purpose on that. Like, I mean, like, I don't...
I know they're saying prep, but, like, last year it was, like, he didn't flash, like, a Renekton stun onto Leia, which then gets him double killed under Turret and Oscarin.
Do
you remember the game I'm talking about? Yeah, there's, like, simple stuff like that, where it's, like, there's such beauty in Razor's play, where he does, like, 95 to 90%, like, correct, and then he just... He just had some absolute travesty. That Kha'Zix game at MSI, where he's like 5-0 to begin with, and then he finishes the game something like 6-7 or something. Like, it's bonkers how like wrong it ends up like going. And it's, again, it's nothing to do with the fact of just pure like criticism. It's wholly bad or wholly good. It's that full thing of like, eventually you do have to take the step and get it over the line. I think this is a great opening game for Fnatic, because the other beautiful thing is, this is a team you can prep a lot for. There's a huge amount of data on this team. Mm. And like all the players' tendencies, there's a huge amount of data on this team.
No, I think this is actually a really interesting one. I'm not saying I fancy Fnatic from the perspective of I think they will win, but I think, you know, I think they have actually a decent chance to win. But obviously, you know, I favour DK here. Right, let's talk about TL versus LNG. I think that's like really cool series. Yeah, I mean, Nymera, what are your thoughts on this? Can NA's macro gods undo LNG? What do you think?
That's the test, isn't it? I think this is the test, right? These are two very stylistically different teams in terms of macro. These are probably the two most macro-centric teams. That doesn't mean they're the best at macro or something like that, but it's the most important to their style. You know, LNG, the way I've described them, is an architect's nemesis. They fucking hate towers. They just destroy them by any means necessary. They're the best tower taking team in the LPL. The way they do that is typically through scout, using his teleport in quite inventive ways.
Who is like playing, by the way, in case anyone
who is now
that.
Playing as well. Typically, who's playing champions which could destroy towers very easily. You know, his Tristana was typically quite good at that. His Jace was very good at that the year before. His Lucian was good at that too as well, points during this year as well. And what he would do is wait for Zucker to push out a lane, teleport to his lane. They'd both double up on the turret. The response was often too late from the enemy team. They'd kill a turret and then they'd kind of flow around the map. They could also just send four people into a lane and then just continually hit towers time after time to kind of pull the enemy team around when they couldn't quite respond in time. So that's a very cool way to play the game. It often gets them a lot of gold, which then hides the fact that they're not actually very good team fighters compared to other LPL teams. Their team fighting is probably their weakest point, which is very strange considering that they're an LPL team. You normally consider team fighting for an LPL team to be like your gold standard. It's not necessarily for LNG, very different kind of team. Whereas with TL, they are one of the most, they have been really the leading experts on lane swaps this year. They have lane swap for different reasons. They've had different objectives in mind. And the conversation we had earlier, I guess to skip back in the timestamps to whenever we talked about that earlier, it was quite near the start, about how lane swaps aren't dead. You just have to know what you're getting from them. Could be very important for TL, because that could actually upset the flowchart, which LNG really likes to play to. LNG plan very specific timings, and they try and use, again, these macro tricks and stuff like that to get themselves set up into like this very regimented flowchart to play the game. I wonder whether TL can use something like these early movements. Umpty is also someone who likes to get involved early as well. He's not necessarily the efficiency power farming jungler. He likes to get involved in the game early. So for me, two very, very different styles of macro. I think it would be very interesting to see whether TL can live up to expectations, actually, that they could make top eight. You know, they didn't win summer, but I think a lot of people were very high on TL, calling them actually, you know, a genuinely very good team. You know, MSI, they had some good moments. I think that, you know, they took T1 to a couple of really good games. I think at EWC as well. I can't remember that one as much. But yeah, I think that this could be a very fun stylistic matchup. And we'll see whether one of these teams has a better view of macro. Of course, LNG might have had a bit of a wobble if they didn't know where the scout was coming. We'll see what the mantle is like as well. And what their take on the meta is. LNG are not particularly a good team at adapting to metas. Scout was talking about that last year. They took a while to get used to the patch changes. We'll see whether this roster iteration is any different. But this is the most cerebral game, I think, out of the first round matchups.
For sure. Also, I think that LNG got doubly lucky because of all the mid laners you could bring. Why would you bring your Gao? Like,
well, he's better in terms of the other stuff, but yeah.
I mean, like, in a... Like, given that they had multiple options for who they could have brought, like, I think...
Did they actually have that many options? Because wasn't there that really weird Riot rule?
You can't have been top six.
They couldn't have Rookie, for example.
It would have been Yagao or Shanks, basically. Can't think of anyone else that would
have. Yeah, I think there's a rule feature where they weren't allowed to have anyone. It wasn't even for, like, the regionals or whatever. It was specifically for summer playoffs. Yeah. You were not allowed to have anyone in the top six. So Rookie just got in to that, and so he disqualified himself from going to the Worlds, basically.
By being too good.
Exactly, yeah.
I mean, for this matchup, I think a lot is going to depend on TL. I think TL... Okay, I've got a bit... So there are people on FlyQuest that I like, you know, like... I like Inspired, I
go on, say it, Peter. Say the line. Yep.
Okay. Here's what I'm going to say. If they lost Game 4, there is no way they're coming back in Game 5, right? Like, FlyQuest in that final. Like, if they don't lose the game to Minions, right, they should have stopped. That final game should have been, like, the easiest FlyQuest win of all time, right? Like, they were so far ahead, and TL found ways to continue to fight that game, right? And then they ended up losing the game on Minions because, right? Like, and to be honest, I think that TL would have won that series knowing what I do about the players involved on both teams, right? Why am I bringing the LCS final up? Because I think it shows TL's biggest strength, right? Which is that they are a team that are not easy to beat. And this is a rarity for North American teams. They're able to overload sides of the map. They have, like, really smart play in the early game. Like, hands-wise, I don't think they're actually that insane. I think FlyQuest are better than them in terms of hands.
Yeah.
I think Cloud9 were better than them when they're not imploding in terms of hands, right? But they...
Historically, I think, I don't know, but, like, JoJo was just straight up, like, dog for half this year, though, wasn't he? Like,
well, sure. But, like, I mean, I think that the way that they're beating FlyQuest and TL, FlyQuest and Cloud9, is not down to the fact that they're hands different.
I agree.
Right. But they have really smart early game plans. I really like how Impact plays his mid game. I really like how he calls resources to lane. I really like how he plays around fog. I think Core JJ is smart, although doesn't really, really messes up things mechanically that he shouldn't mess up at this point. But, you know, he's, how old is
he? He's terrible mechanically. He's one of the worst, like, supports mechanically I've seen in, like, a long time. Like, absolutely, like, dreadful.
He must be, sure, what, like, I mean, 28, 29?
Your hands, but, I mean, it's nothing to do with age. Like, people just fucking bring up age. Like, Flash is fucking in his 30s, mechanics are unbelievable. Yeah,
but like, he mechanically messes up things. But because he's so often in the right place at the right time...
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
It matters, but it doesn't matter as much as it should matter, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what do I think about the series? I think... We'll see how well LNG are prepped to lane swaps. I think they are a team that are vulnerable to being cheesed. I think they're a team that is...
Break the,
I mean, if they go into the series and TL lane swap on them and they're not fully prepared for it, I think that, you know, frankly, their coaches should be, like, given a very stern talking to by senior management. But, like, you know, I could see... I'm not pessimistic on TL at this World Cup. I think that there are... I think this is a team that could realistically make top eight. They're either going to make top eight or they're going to come really, really close. I think that they're, against international competition, they match up better than FlyQuest. I was going to say FlyQuest and 100 Thieves, but obviously better than 100 Thieves. But like, yeah, well, we just have to see. We have to see. You know, a lot will depend on what happens with Botlane in the series.
What do you think, Kira? By the way, just very quickly, my theory, okay, I've always been someone who's against like the whole, you know, people's hands fall off as they get older. But to Peter's point, by the way, if you didn't know, Cordia is 30, which is quite interesting. I don't think that people's hands necessarily get worse unless you like neglect to play.
Is it Turin's 30 or our 30?
I don't know.
Oh, okay.
94, I think.
Not fair enough.
Yes, yeah, no, so R30. But I think that what happens is a player starts his career, let's say in like 2016 or whenever, mm-hmm. and then he starts playing and improving and getting better at the game, and then he'll plateau in mechanics at a certain point, and then obviously, you know, he's getting older the whole time, and then the newer generations typically have better hands anyway, especially if a game's not a million years old. So basically the catch-up happens, and then players either go past him or plateau at the same time as him or whatever. And then you see the correlation of age and mechanics. And the age and mechanics versus his peers might be going down, but it's not actually to do with age. It's due to the fact that Core JJ was playing in World Finals in fucking 2016 or whenever the fuck it was. And yeah, you don't, your mechanics aren't just a straight line into infinity. Spoiler alert, Chovy's going to get caught by mid laners in a couple of years. That's going to happen. It's not going to be because he's old.
Then I've got a question here. Sorry, but is impact the exception that proves the rule, or is impact?
That just, is a is, good. That, yeah, no. I mean, I think he is kind of an anomaly.
He hasn't really an anomaly. Like certain people, not entirely. Like
who's yeah, remotely comparable? The only guy who's remotely comparable is Faker with this, and Faker's like versus where he was versus his peers.
Double F was like arguably the best mechanics and like some of the best mechanics in season 2, and then by the time in like season 8 he was still had some of the best mechanics, and then by season 9 he was still extremely mechanically proficient. Like it's not like it's there's
you're dealing with way less time
longevity in terms of, I mean there are people who have peaked better towards the end of their career. There have been
Double If, like, dude, just... Double If was dog shit when he retired. And it's not the same, retired, dude. Impact. Think of Impact.
Impact wasn't good at the start, though.
Yeah, but season one doesn't even count.
Also, it depends if
he doesn't get props for that.
Yeah, but also depends whether you're talking about the best in the world or just like people compared to their average level. Because there are plenty of people in minor regions, for instance, who have like upped their level year after year and have been playing for a very long time. But then there's the question of, you know, is this just like an upper level thing in terms of like the best players in the world can never say the best in the world, or like if they're best in the world, they won't reach that again or something like that. Also, I mean, there's a bunch of different things in terms of some people just fit towards certain metas a little bit more, or there's like one odd meta where they don't or something like that.
Impact has the best longevity of any player ever. Like,
right, that's a completely different thing. But like, the problem is,
an anomaly, in my opinion.
There's an argument, for sure.
In the sense of like, Impact has been like very like the same for like a long period of time. It's just Impact's played against less people where you've seen it ever been a problem more and more as his career went on.
It's not fully like as in like he wasn't playing consistently against LCK LPL top.
I watched
really
Impact
show his
be worse than Hune in season 8. Impact was worse than Hune. Listen to the dates I'm saying here. Impact was worse mechanically than Hune in season 8 by miles. By like, Impact couldn't win tank matchups. Hune was out mechanicking him in tank matchups on like Sion. Just fucking auto attack, walk away. And Impact was literally just, his brain was exploding live on stage as he couldn't actually click on Hune when he was trying to last hit minions.
To be fair though, this is like a completely different point where you're basically saying that he didn't.
I didn't think he was ever proficient, so his longevity doesn't surprise me. I don't think Core JJ was ever that proficient, so it's really hard to be really proficient and keep it all the time. That makes sense when that tapers off, when it's a huge part of your game. Almost at no point in his career for me Impact was ever massively proficient mechanically at any point in time.
He had good international tournaments since then, so I don't really buy that. I just yeah, he had dips, yeah, sure. Well, like, great. He was in Kasuni for a split. Okay.
No, okay. I don't really want to get into this. We can talk about this a completely separate time because I've watched a lot. Because Impact was on a lot of teams that I was a fan of, I've watched an awful lot of like Impact like multiple times, and it's a completely different argument. More to do with the thing of like, I think, again, Impact for his team supplies like a very, very unique skill. Sorry, you go, Peter, because you want to say something.
The only reason I brought up Impact was, you know, is Impact the exception that proves the rule in this case, which is kind of what we discussed, but is it that NA is just weaker?
Well, that factors into it as well, obviously,
By the way,
but he's good internationally almost always.
Yeah, but when you're looking in the time scale of like Faker Impact, Quadra JJ, I actually think it's more about lifestyle stuff than gameplay stuff. It's way more about like your you know, your longevity in terms of like what are you getting out of your career, what's your life looking like, are you set, you settled. That's more important, because I think once you get past like a couple of years, 5 years or something like that, then players are like, okay, what am I doing with my life and stuff like that, are they enjoying it? That's actually the thing which is more important. Do you have a plan for when you leave esports, something like that, so you know you have a fallback option? Because I think a bunch of people have gotten to a point like, yeah, okay, I'm not achieving what I want to here, or I'm not happy doing this. That's actually more important for me. I think once you get to a certain level of skill, or you're like, or a certain level of reputation or something like that, you're earning a certain amount, I think it makes it a lot easier. So I think that's, anyway, a lot of other topics, but I think that's actually a bigger thing than a lot of people are.
No, I agree. And I think they get smarter as well, which obviously improves on their longevity about the game. But yeah, sorry, go on, Kira. What is your underlying take on TL LNG?
So one of the weird things is, I wonder what APA is going to play. Like, I think that's going to be interesting, where he's going to like move his specialities and his pertinencies. Then that could be super interesting. It'll be really cool to see Weiwei in this jungle meta. I'm not sure it suits him that much. He could play some Poppy, which is always fun. Weiwei's Poppy is always chaotic, to say the least. One thing is, I actually don't think... So LNG, you were talking about LNG and being like a macro team. One thing that doesn't suit LNG is their setups when Scout doesn't have leads and is able to like pressure the side that the setup's happening on and they can bounce off of that are really poor. They're really, really bad. Hang's like just fucking terrible at it, and Weiwei, don't even get me started. So disappointed in Weiwei this year. Basically, like, he almost showed no improvement in this regard from the start to the end of
Last year. He also doesn't have stuff like Rell, Poppy, level 3 junglers. He might be better at Worlds because he's better at the level 3 gremlin style than farming efficiency.
They missed Tarzan so much in this team. But anyway, well, most teams would miss Tarzan. But at the end of the day, like, I actually think TL has got a lot that they can like abuse here. The only thing that kind of like scares me, and this is a lot of potentially, if Impact makes it to mid-game, like split, or they like lane swap and Impact's able to outvalue struggle with that one, but I actually think he'll outvalue him massively. I think Zika was like basically an emblematic thing of like player ability to play a game doesn't just go straight up. It does just very often like plateau or regress in some dynamics. Not to say that he's bad, he definitely should be in the LPL.
I think he's actually the unsung hero of this team. He does a lot of legwork, but yeah, he's probably not someone I would... I think he's more stable than some LPL top laners. I think he'd do fine. But just that, I feel like Impact and Zuka are actually not dissimilar players. I just think Impact is more on form in that style right now.
But I think you, end up outvaluing them, like, and going into like mid games and stuff, particularly like, on in terms of how TL like use them, and then in particular to the fact of the propensity of like setting up like plays and objective, setting up for objectives and like playing those objectives. I think. The difference between LNG when Scout doesn't have leads and when they have leads, I think is massive. I think they're so desperate for Scout to like have those and be able to like pressure them. And when they do that, I think not they could beat anybody, but you know they have a winning the ability to basically give anyone issues. But when they don't have that, I think a lot of the times they like fall apart. The only upside I actually see is like Gal is actually playing extremely well right now.
So I remember I was on Summoning Insight and I had this chat as well, because like I think some people's opinions are Gala had a bad playoff, so people are quite down on him. If you look beyond, and I agree, his playoffs weren't great. If you look at his whole summer, Gala's had one of his best splits of his career. He beat Ruler in the series for the first time ever. I think he beat him like in a best of one at Worlds 2020, something like that. He also low-key diffed Jackalove in a couple of the series that they had this summer as well. So I actually think Gala had a really good split. I think he was.
He lost all of his 2v2s against like top esports, basically because his support's Hang and the other guy's support was Mako.
Yeah, Jackalove, like Mako individually was playing well.
Yeah, exactly. I think Hang.
I actually haven't watched the specific matches in a while, but I remember like one of the notes I wrote down was like Gala. This is one of Gala's best individual splits on his own. And his Ziggs was fucking incredible, by the way. He's the best Ziggs in the LPL. Fantastic Kaiser, obviously. He's got a bunch of stuff he can really whip out and do damage with.
Here's the litmus test. Again, we're back at this point, Rich. We're back here again. If you go count how many close games TL have had with everybody, my God, is this team a legacy of close games? True. These games have got to stop being close, and they've got to start being wins. Because again, they're going to be at the back of the queue behind Fnatic. Right, okay, and every other Western team's in that queue. Close isn't good enough. Do you think Chinese teams sit and they go, oh, we were close with TL? No, like nobody thinks like that. Like, you only deal in Ws, okay? Yeah. And again, it's another real interesting matchup to see, you know, how good like TL is. I really hope the whole Scout Yagal thing hasn't fucked up the team too much and that they can get practice so that the matchup's actually quite interesting. I don't think particularly LNG is going in on the best individual form I've ever seen from the players and their team form. However, you know, the reset could have a lot to say. And I think I'm really interested to see what the team's priority picks are going to be. Particularly for TL, like what they're going to be picking in mid lane and what they're going to be picking in top lane as well.
Spoiler alert.
Could be super interesting.
But yeah, no, I agree. I think this is a really interesting series. So there's one more bet that I want to talk about here, which is LEC team. This is under the specials, guys. If you go and you click on the world specials.
Oh, no.
LEC team will go higher than LCS team in the tournament. Now, it's at nearly 3-1 that won't happen, which I think is a great bet because it's like 50-50 who goes further out of G2 or Team Liquid, in my opinion, or like close to 50-50. Obviously, the draw will depend a lot as well, right? Like, we don't know necessarily what that's going to look like. So I think this is a great bet. Like, yeah, I'm betting against my own region, I guess, in that sense. But to me, I mean, this is kind of a flip. Also, like, I mean, FlyQuest probably aren't going to factor in, but FlyQuest aren't like complete dog shit, you know. Again, depending on how the bracket goes, it's not like inconceivable, but this to me is essentially you're betting who will go further, G2 or Team Liquid. Now, I think G2 will probably go further, but again, bracket dependent. And how close, by the way, going into the tournament, if you were to like poll people who's a better team, Liquid or G2, it would be pretty close. Like, the polls would be pretty close, and I don't think these odds are reflective of that opinion, essentially. So actually, I think this is worth a bet. Again, this is one I'm going to be kind of like, you know how I've hedged this bet, Kira? Again, I win either way, because either, you know, Mother Europe takes it, and sure, I'm out some money, but, you know, we are what we are, or I can wipe my EU tears with filthy NA money. So we win either way. So again, I'm putting 50 on that. Or do I put 100 on that? Ooh.
Rich, calm down. These types of bets where you do these types of evaluation, do you feel that strong? Do you feel, you just said to me it's a 50-50. Do you feel that strong about it, Rich?
We'll do 50.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah. Ride the horses on. This isn't a sprint, Rich. You know, we've got plenty of planes to go.
Yeah, no, we'll do 50. Now, again, as always, guys, obviously gamble responsibly. Never bet what you can't afford. And remember that with Thunderpick, as long as you deposit at least €20, they will double whatever you deposit up to a value of 600. Of course, if you use my beautiful code at the top there, Rich's Wrath. So, yeah, and also, for whatever reason, you're just struggling to access the site for some reason, take a holiday, you know, maybe go to Germany. I hear you can get there very quickly through certain means, you know, maybe Portugal. I will say it doesn't really matter which one you go to. If you're in America, Brazil, also lovely nearly all year round. So, you know, it's never more than a stone's throw away, if you really think about it. In this case,
Scotland's really cold this time of year.
Yeah, well, actually, you can't go to Scotland. That won't help you, as far as I know. So, yeah, it's one of those places. I'm sure there are ways of getting cheap flights. Am I right? Anyway, yeah. Thanks, guys. And let me know how your bets go. Oh, I almost forgot. Actually, no, never mind. We'll do that next time. But I actually told a lie. We are somehow going to have talked about all these series very quickly, the last one, because, you know, we're on a time budget here. So I just want to get Peter's thoughts quickly on Gen G versus Weibo, which is another one. What do you think of this? What do you think of this series, Peter?
Gen G are going to win that, right? Like, I mean, Gen G are, despite the fact that they lost the finals, I think they are at worst the top two team in the world. Think that, I mean, I mean, how can Weibo win? Like,
How indeed?
Oh, no, there is actually. No, there isn't.
Okay, go on.
It is objectively the funniest thing possible for them to win, and therefore they will. It is just the way Weibo.
You know,
Weibo objectively do the funniest thing available to them. Ruin our finals, somehow knock out like Ruler from Worlds. Objectively funniest thing. That is the way this team works. Like, I shit you not, this team is just going to do well this time.
Weibo isn't coming straight to Europe, by the way, Peter. They're going to Korea first, to the Temple of KT, to fucking pray and leave gifts. Because only KT, only KT can supply the answers. You know what I mean? But Jalhu's going to sit and talk to BDD and ask him how does one do it?
To me, Mad Lions have more chance of beating BLG. Tell me.
The way they win is through Tarzan having a really, really, really good first clear and managing to get Breathe onto something like a Snowball top matchup, which then gets out of control. I think Breathe winning lead is really big. Xiao, who's better on mages than he is on AD carries, most of the time his AD carries weren't bad, but if you get him stuff like Syndra, he's one of the best Syndras of all time as well. Obviously, Chovy, not a Syndra player, very famously. It's one of the few champions he's never really managed to get onto. So there are some draft advantages. I think Light is having one of the splits of his whole career as well.
Yep.
Like, Weibo have incredible potential.
Tarzan can accelerate bot lane, 100%.
I mean, Weibo's path to win versus Mad is that they have really fucking good players in every position but support.
Basically, what you're hoping for, it's a best of one. Tarzan is an incredible early pather, so not that Canyon isn't, but I think if Tarzan managed to get a really good early path with a good early game plan and a best of one, they could snowball through one of their lanes to a win. It's not impossible. Weibo are still an LPL team, despite them being... either one. It depends on the draft. I think they're actually a very versatile.
Breathe is not like as high a stock as he was like a year or so ago, like coming into Worlds.
It's just that his playstyle is get ahead. And if you look at LPL finals in LPL finals, he actually was matching Bin.
Yeah.
He was. He got 1v2 outplays in top lane. I think his regionals after that were poor. But if he plays at that level, there's a chance he could actually bring in some real value to that play. You are against Keen. Keen is, of course, one of the best top laners in the world too. But like, I think it depends on draft. I think that Tarzan is a very good player at kind of adjusting his method to the madness of the game or whatever's happened there. They're kind of like a mini BLG like that, very good at kind of adjusting to who gets ahead. It's still an uphill battle, but because they are such a weird early game team, there is a chance.
I think Breathe is the second most talented carry top lane player on certain picks in the world, like unironically. I don't think he's lost
GP?
I think he's like, you know, much more limited Fiora. Than his Fiora is unbelievable. Oh, he won't be playing it in this game probably, but he's unbelievable as these carry players as a talent.
Yeah, Breathe's sick. Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, Breathe is sick.
So is Tarzan. So is Xiaohu. Yeah. Most of the time.
That's the other thing too. Like, Xiaohu's had a shit year. Xiaohu's had a shit year, but if Xiaohu just gets to Worlds and is like, well, okay, matters changed, majors are back, Xiaohu is still one of the best players of all time. He could also have, like, just randomly just show up as peak Xiaohu as well. It's a low chance, but it's worth mentioning, right? Because he's had a bad year.
To me, I felt they were pretty poor, and I feel like they're kind of lucky to be here. Oh, I'm going to be careful. There's a lot of Weibo fans. Like, I feel that JDG's gone. Yeah. But I mean, like, I feel that they could easily have lost that series against JDG.
Well, yeah, but they played, like, 25 games within, like, a week or some shit. Like, they played, like, a bunch of best of fives all back-to-back-to-back. So
the trial by fire makes steel sharp.
Yeah, I put less weight on the JDG series than I do on a couple of their others. Like, look... Yeah, I think the LNG series was also like a best of five straight after finals. Look, that string of games, fucking awful. But also, if anyone has watched Weibo for any length of time, this team will always somehow find a way to do the funniest thing possible. They are consistently inconsistent. This team does not follow logic. They are our version of KT Rolster. I have to portend the fucking omens with this team. They upset me, but they will still somehow make a world fucking finals.
Why are KT, Weibo Gaming, and fucking
Fnatic
all the same team? Like, it doesn't matter,
They are the court jester. They're the only people allowed to speak the truth, but the people are not allowed to hear it. They are the court jester. they have a very important role within the throne room.
I'm so looking forward to Worlds.
Yeah, I think we're all probably picking Gen G for this one. I think the biggest difference as well is obviously like Gen G's replicable team play is like much beyond what, you know, you would expect from Weibo. But again, best of one. And you have to say, in the context of a best of one...
I'm just spelling it out. KT could beat them. Why not Weibo?
Those five players can beat anyone. Like, those five players could beat the best five players in the world in, like, a best of one in any given, like, single game.
Except BLG.
Well, yeah, maybe. But anyway, that is going to be it for this week, guys. Do make sure to stick around for our tier list show that we'll be doing with Monty later this week as well. And thank you very much, Peter, for joining us. He's given Weibo a 0% chance to win, so bet the house on them. And yeah, we will see you next time.